Hey, good afternoon, and welcome here to the campus of Montana Tech. Frontier Conference football here at on Montana Tech Stream. Thanks for joining us as we make our way through a Saturday afternoon. Paul Podisco, Ron Haskett, as the Digs getting ready to take on the Battling Bears here on a Saturday afternoon. This will be the 135th meeting between Montana Tech and kind of all the cogs that make up Rocky Mountain College. We can talk about that as the afternoon continues. But again, thanks for joining us here as we're on the Montana Tech Stream. Ron Haskett, Paul Podisco, how you doing?
I'm good. I was 4-4 against Rocky when I played, so of course I'm good.
I'm glad you came because we were talking about it the other day and you couldn't quite remember how things went, so I was gonna quiz you about it.
I figured it out. You know what? Coach Green's first year, so that would have been the fall of 1987. Me and one of my old teammates, Chris Darr, were trying to remember. We had 4 wins that year, you know, and that was coming off 1 year and one win in 2 years,
okay,
in my freshman and sophomore year. And so we had 4 wins, and we couldn't come up with that 4th win. It ended up being Shadron State came to town, and we beat them. I talked to Mark Moudry about it and confirmed it with Coach Green in the tailgate. But, we swept Rocky in 1987 and 1988. So we didn't have a lot of sweeps when I played. So
there you go.
There's a little bit of good history there.
So, you know, the Rocky Mountain College, I mentioned it's the 135th meeting, and I've gotten quizzed about that quite a bit. But what it does is Rocky Mountain College was originally, the school started as Montana Wesleyan in Helena. Montana Wesleyan was started in 1907. It changed its name to Intermountain Union, I believe, in 1927, 1928. And then after 1921, they merged with Billings Polytechnic. They moved to Billings, and that's when they became Rocky Mountain College officially in 1949. So there was time there where, you know, Tech had played Intermountain Union and Billings Poly in the same years through the 20s and 30s at times, and I combined all those, and that's where we get the 135 meetings between the programs.
Gotcha, yeah.
That'll be on the
test.
Seems
like a lot of work. Yeah, I will fail that test along with a lot of other ones I've failed in my career.
Well, let's talk about these programs, and let's start things off actually in the Frontier Conference as we have 2 undefeateds right now, Montana Tech being one of those. They are nationally ranked, coming in number 21 of the country. The College of Idaho is the other undefeated in the Frontier Conference. They currently sit, I believe, at 18 in the national rankings, and they are 2-0. The Bulldogs of UM Western are 2-1. They are 1-1 in conference. They did use the week last week to take down Dickinson State. Dickinson is 3-30 against Frontier schools since 2012.
2 more wins than I thought they had.
So that is where things look there. So UM Western nationally ranked, still the highest ranked team actually in the Frontier Conference on the national stage. Carroll College is 1-1. These Rocky Mountain College, Battling Bears also 1-1. Southern Oregon 1-1. Eastern is 0-2 and 0-3 overall. They played Whitworth and got hammered by Whitworth, honestly, in Spokane this past weekend.
Who played them, Eastern or Southern?
Eastern.
Eastern, okay.
Yeah, Eastern went to Spokane in a game that was originally Tech's.
Right.
Tech had Whitworth on the schedule first. They backed out of the game with Tech and took the game with Eastern, and they beat up on Eastern in a pretty handily way this past weekend.
Might be the decision of the year, actually, you know, because Montana Tech had their way with Eastern as well. And, people were asking last weekend about the games, and I said, you know, it's a conference week off. A couple the teams had scheduled some non-conference action, and I talked about Whitworth. You know, in my 11 or 12 years, whatever it was, coaching at Montana Tech, Whitworth was my favorite, most beautiful campus.
It was really nice.
Yeah, it's really nice. You know, I still remember they had an ex golf course superintendent who took care of his 3 responsibilities were the baseball field, the soccer field, and the football field, and they were immaculate. It was, but all in all, you know, all red brick buildings, beautiful tree-covered campus. It was my favorite. That and Willamette.
And I was thinking, and I just went back in my history to look. The game at Whitworth was one of my first years calling games, and the people there were incredibly nice, and I'll never forget because the guy, you know, they were so apologetic. They're like, we don't have anywhere inside for you, but we will put you outside. We'll make sure you're covered. We'll have power and everything you need at that game. And we went over, and it was extremely hot. It was September 19th of 1998, and we went over, and the sun was beating down, and they had me under a black tarp. And I remember it was like a microwave. You know, I think I went in at about 380 pounds and came out at about 220. Same thing, where I was incredibly impressed by the facilities. The field was immaculate. And it's one of my 2 favorite fields, because the other one will always be Azusa. When we went to Azusa, I mean, that thing was a, like you could have brought the step meter out for golf on that bad boy. That was an incredible turf.
You know, the most interesting, so this might predate you, but when we went and played in the, and at this time they had two different divisions in NAIA. They had Division One, Division Two, and we were Division One in 96, and we made it to the NAIA National Championship in Weatherford, Oklahoma. And the grass had gotten dormant, but they painted the field green.
Okay.
It was literally spray painted green, and it was a carpet a lot like Azusa Pacific. You know, it was a let's just call it a fast track.
Yeah. So, well, again, thanks for joining us here on a Saturday as we talk about grass all of a sudden. I mean, that probably isn't real surprising for you, because you are that guy that has to have your grass perfect, right?
Well, I like, don't get me wrong, I like green grass, but it's funny to, you know, in the era of the legalization of marijuana, we're still talking about either bent Bermuda, Kentucky blue, or ryegrass, you know?
So we'll move on from that. Let's talk about these two teams. The Digs come in 2-0, playing really good football. You know, they go on the road to Eastern, which is always a very tough place to really start your season, and especially not knowing what Eastern presents. Eastern is a much different team this year, you know, with some new coaching changes, you know, a lot of graduation there as well. So there was a lot of questions for that Montana Tech team going to Eastern. They roll in LeGrand, and they turn around, and then you go, okay, that was week one. Let's see what happens next week when Carroll College comes to town. It's always a game that everybody has circled on their calendar. I don't care what side of it you're on. And Montana Tech 2 weeks ago rolled again. I mean, there was never any doubt as to what was going to happen in that football game in the second half. It was only a two-score game, but it felt like a much bigger, deficit for Carroll in that second half, even though it was only two scores.
You can talk all you want about the success of Montana Tech. Jet Campbell's having a nice year.
Yep.
But I'm telling you right now, and you could hear it a little bit in the Carroll broadcast, he can be better. He can. You know, he can be better and more consistent, and he does great things. And, you know, I mentioned, you know, when he's comfortable, he's as accurate a passer as I've ever seen, you know, but sometimes there's some discomfort there, and I don't really know what it is, but the success of this team so far is clearly the defense. They are playing really good football. They're under the direction of Eric Williams. This is his first stint as D coordinator here at Montana Tech. I got a little bit of the history now. So was he the D coordinator at Idaho for Paul Petrino?
Yes.
Is that where he came from?
Yeah.
So, and I like what he does. You know, they've had a couple guys really stand out. I look at Trumbull and James Newby, even though I tried to rename him about 100 times in the first broadcast, but Keyshawn James Newby at defensive end, they're playing really well. They've grown up a little bit at middle linebacker. I really like what Cole Wyant has developed into there at middle linebacker, but the emergence of Ben Windauer.
Yes.
In that, you know, and I think he's that defense's leading tackler right now. He's playing really good football. In the secondary, they got guys that have been here forever. Naoki Harmer, Jake Orvis. And then you look at cornerback Jordan Washington, who's having a great early part of the season. But that defense of theirs is playing really, really good football right now.
They're number 8 in the country in actually a couple different respects. They're only allowing 220 yards a game. That is good for number 2 in the country. And also points. They're only giving up in the two games, 6.5 points is the average. And that is also good for number 8 in the country. So the defense really getting things done. And it's like you said, it's not one position group. You know, it's all 11. Yeah. We're getting great pass rush. We're getting a lot of pressure on the quarterback. The linebackers doing their job, and they're going to be a unit that's going to be taxed today. And we'll talk about that more as we continue. But you know, that secondary group is, as you mentioned, they've been together forever. I mean, these are guys that have been together and a solid unit for a really long time, and they are playing lights out across the board. And this Digger defense has led them to their 2-0 record and into the top 25 this week.
Montana Tech gave Carroll College a little dose of what Mike Van Deest in his Carroll Saints used to give us back in the early 2000s and early to mid 2000s. You know, when I say that 120-yard game, we had a couple of those, and those hurt, you know, as an offensive staff.
Yeah.
I mean, when you can't figure anything out, and, you know, we actually, when we were reviewing the stats post-game, we weren't even sure those were accurate, but, you know, 120-some total yards for Carroll College's offense when they came in here,
yep.
That's unbelievable what Montana Tech did to Carroll to stifle them. They got up 9 points, and the game looked like it was over. You know, it really did, because you just never felt too uncomfortable with what Montana Tech was doing defensively. And Carroll College's lack of offense, you know, any kind of light, I guess, is the easiest way to put it. They just couldn't figure them out.
Well, we talked about the defense being number 8 in the country. The offense is also in the top 25 in some stat percentages. They sit at number 23 in the country for yards a game. As this Montana Tech team, Jet Campbell already 467 yards passing. He's averaging 233.5 a game. He's thrown 3 touchdowns, no turnovers in the interception or the fumble category. That's one you and I have talked about it forever, and it's just one of those that might not get the attention it deserves. But Montana Tech is plus 5. They have not turned the ball over yet this year, so they have taken the ball away from their opponent 5 more times and they have given it up, and that plus 5 is a huge margin. And talking to Coach Sampson earlier this week, that's a number they just want to keep ballooning and getting bigger and bigger. And that's one of those stats that doesn't lie. If you're a successful team, if you're winning your conference, you're going to the national tournaments, those teams are going to be in the plus. That's all there is to it. You're not going to be successful turning the ball over more than you take it away. So this team right now at plus 5 with 5 turnovers as opposed to 0 for themselves, that's a big number coming into the third game of the year.
Clearly an emphasis for this team, you know, no doubt. Blake counts. Now, you're going to find running backs in the country that are maybe a little faster than counts. You'd be hard-pressed to find anybody a little stronger. But Counts holds on to the football. He picks and chooses his holes pretty well. But he does a nice job of patiently waiting for his offensive front to do their job before he'll run up into a hole. And the bottom line is he takes care of the ball. Campbell, back there, he's careful. He's accurate. And sometimes he'll get running around out there. You talk about his tendencies to maybe try and escape on the edge versus step up and find seams. We saw in that Carroll game in the second half, he really started to step up and find seams, and he can keep plays alive with his feet, which is huge versus throwing the ball into traffic. So
yeah, this offense, like we say, is doing some great things. And as I look down on the sidelines, the Digs are getting ready to come through the gates here in a moment. But down south of us here, as we look down on the table, is going to be Mark Estes. Estes, of course, went out in the before game one. He has not seen a snap this year. He's one of the guys that they ran a lot of the offensive plays through. He was certainly public enemy number one. The young man had an incredible year last year. This year they came in going, we've got to get him touches. It doesn't matter if it's receptions, doesn't matter if it's special teams. He is one of the most electric guys at the NAIA level. He is out for the season. And I asked Coach Sampson earlier this week that, you have a pretty big chunk of your playbook designated for Estes. How do you spread that out? And he goes, I think we've done a good job of that so far. Hoffman has a lot of touches. You're looking at Torgerson is having a great year to this point, but we still have a lot of guys in that receiving core and even depth at running back that we're going to start moving into those kind of plays that we had designed to get the ball into Mark Estes's hands.
Well, I was just going to say that. Estes is one thing, but they're really loaded.
Yeah. That unit is the most depth they have at any position, for goodness sake.
You look at what they'd call their X and Z receiver. You're talking about Wyatt Alexander, Trevor Hoffman. Torgerson's having a great year, and they're deep behind those guys too. And the one guy that we haven't talked to, he's seeing the bulk of the snaps now. He used to be more of a pass heavy set guy, Logan Kennedy there at tailback, tight end. He's really grown in to a 100% extension of their offensive line and a great ball catcher.
Yeah, he's turned into that four down tight end, where before he's always had great hands, but we certainly see him a lot more in blocking scenarios and kind of just across the board, a lot more integral part of this offense.
I was just talking in the tailgate, remember Taggart used to come in on the run heavy sets and stuff like that the last 4 years. He would swap out with Kennedy. I just talked to Taggart and Tyler Folks a little bit about that whole concept. And, so he's seen Logan Kennedy and seen what he's grown into as a tight end, and it's pretty impressive.
Well, again, thanks for joining us here as we are with Montana Tech. The Digs taking on the Battling Bears of Rocky Mountain College. They played twice a year ago. Montana Tech won both of those contests. The game in Billings was one of the most insane games I've been a part of in a long time. Tech went up huge in the first half, and then Nathan Dick and company went, hold on a second, I got something to say. And that was a game that could have been won. Rocky went for two, and Nathan Dick just lost his footing. He went to the turf, and Montana Tech got the win in an incredible game there. We've got our national anthem, so with it, we will pause. We're back right after this. Once again, a welcome here to the campus of Montana Tech. Ordinger football here on a Saturday afternoon. Frontier Conference action as the Battling Bears come to town to take on the Digs. Let's talk about the Bears a little bit. And if you start with anybody but Nathan Dick, I just question you, because this young man, he gets hurt against the College of Idaho 2 weeks ago. Sits out some of the fourth quarter. He doesn't practice much from what I understand here the last couple of weeks. He isn't listed as their starter on the depth chart. And he strikes me as one of those players. He's one that I like to brag about, that I was able to watch all of, you know, his games at Billings Senior. He's a guy that I loved watching play the game of football. And I would be absolutely shocked if Nathan Dick doesn't start in this. He's always struck me as one of those just tougher than nails kids. We'll see. He is out there. He is dressed. He was taking warm-up snaps. It did feel like he was getting like your quote-unquote one starter reps, but it does feel like the other guys were getting as quite a few reps as well. So we'll kind of see how things go. But Nathan Dick, obviously one of the most electric players in this conference leading out the Battling Bears today.
Yeah, and defensively you have to be aware of that, okay? So if he comes into the game and he's a little beat up, and I don't know what the rumored injury is.
It's foot of some sort.
Yeah. So what do you do offensively? You try to get the ball out of his hand a little quicker. So you have to know that defensively. You have to know that as defensive back. You know, maybe bring your coverage a little closer to your receiver. But defensively, you got to know to get your hands up on that defensive front and look for maybe some more quick hitters versus him running around, because he is really athletic too. You know, on top of having a great throwing arm, he's really athletic.
Yeah.
And you know, he's one of those guys you really have to be conscious of escaping the pocket and moving chains with his feet.
Yeah, he's just electric. He can do it with his feet. He can do it with his arms. And we'll see what that presents. So, again, he is not on the official two deep, but I assume that's gamesmanship. And I was kind of giving Coach Sampson a hard time about that, as they list George Tribble, a junior, as the starting quarterback. And his backup is on paper, JT Allen out of Glacier. So we'll see if that holds. But I'd be really hard-pressed to believe that we will not see Nathan Dick here today. And the other kind of different thing out of Rocky today that we haven't seen over the last couple of years, they're going to kind of go with a single running back system. You know, they're led by one guy basically in the running back column, and that is Wilcox. Wilcox, 33 carries, 162 yards. Nathan Dick, their second leading rusher. They historically, when I say they, Rocky Mountain College historically has been a running back committee. You know, as far back, I shouldn't say as far back as I can remember, but at least the last 5-6 years, it has felt like they're 4 or 5 deep at running back, and they just kind of rotate through them, and they're going more to a true single back system now.
Boy, it's kind of fascinating to look at the roster of two deeps out of Rocky Mountain College. you know, a couple Montana kids. They're from all over the country. I mean, you're
all
talking
over.
East Coast, South, Southeast, Midwest. They are loaded with players from every corner of this country.
You know, they do get a lot of Arizona kids, and that was a question I received this week. But remember, they do a big camp in Arizona. You know, they're part of a multi-institution camp in the Arizona area, you know, certainly somewhere where the Frontier Conference is broadening out to. Since our last broadcast, it's been announced that Arizona Christian will join as a Frontier football member. This is just me. This is has no nobody important or nobody with any intellect says this, but I can't imagine Ottawa of Arizona isn't far behind, personally.
Oh, gotcha.
So that would put us at, what, 10 teams?
10 teams.
I like it. So Montana Tech will kick off here. The Digs wearing the black, Rocky, wearing white jerseys and black pants.
Getting close to a super conference.
There we go. And the kick is away, and another absolute boomer out the back of the end zone. The kicking game and special teams game for Montana Tech has been a real bonus so far in the early part of this season.
Yeah, Lowry's meeting it. He hits it. He meets it and hits it hard. He hits it high and hits it long.
So, again, Rocky Mountain College on their depth chart does not show Nathan Dick. We'll talk about the rest of them. Zaire Wilcox at running back. Andrew Simon out of Whitehall, Montana, is the tight end. You've got Danico Killian, a receiver. Trey Henry, a receiver. And Joseph Dwyer is at receiver. And Nathan Dick and company do come out. So the gamesmanship starts, and Dick will start at quarterback. And, again, I would have been really shocked if not. Nathan Dick, a senior out of Billings, played at Billings Senior. First and 10. Split backs, three receivers. Dick out of the shotgun. Montana Tech in their nickel package, showing pressure from the bottom side. We'll see if they bring it here. Now we're going to get a delay a game right out of the gate. Delay a game against Rocky. Just felt like some confusion there. They got set and kind of popped up and out of there a couple times, so that'll back them up five. And that has been the one thing. We have seen a lot of penalties so far here in this early part of the season.
It's tough to tell. You know, Nathan Dick's looking, you know, dead downfield at the play clock, but I, you know, it's visible, but I wouldn't call it extremely visible.
Yeah. Split back, stay that way. First down at 15. Dick gets the handoff. Actually, he's going to keep it himself, and he'll get two, maybe three, as he tries to keep it between the tackles and pounds it straight ahead.
And they just tried a little split back inside zone off the left side, and Nathan Dick kept the ball. You know, so at that point, you know, with his two lead backs, it almost turns into an isolation play. But you know, you're running right into a guy there that's having a tremendous year. In that case, it was Zach Trumbull.
Second down and 12. Dick, one back, three receivers to his right, one wide left. Nathan Dick gets the snap, play action. He's going to air it up. Pass complete out across the 30. That's his tight end, and Simon. And that will be the first catch of the day for Andrew Simon.
Just a choice route from Simon. He read the zone coverage he was seeing, just a four-man rush. And once again, you know, you talk about what are we going to look at from Rocky. That ball was thrown in under a second.
Simon originally started his collegiate career here at Montana Tech, transferred to Rocky. And I believe it was basketball was where he started here. I shouldn't say believe. I'd place the wager on that. Third down and three. Split backs again, three receivers. Montana Tech, nickel package is in. Dick got the Tech defense to show their hand a little bit. And Tech still bringing the blitz. Dick stepping back, airs it up downfield, has a man complete across the 45, out to the 47-yard line. And looks like brought down there is going to be Killian Jr.
Yeah, they sniffed out a little press corner coverage out there to the wide side. And they kept their wide guy. You know, they ran him on the runoff, and then they flared the back to keep the corner's attention.
Quick snap, handoff to the tailback, gets to midfield as the handoff there goes to Wilcox. So Zaire Wilcox, a sophomore out of Florida, gets his first carry of the day. That'll bring up second and 7 as Rocky went with a real quick snap that time through.
Numbers are a lot easier to see today.
Oh, it's so nice. Second and 7. One receiver left, two to the right. Nathan Dick out of the shotgun. Tight end, and Simon moves to the left side of the formation. Man in motion is going to be Killian. He'll stop in the slot. Long snap count again. Play action, wants to throw. Has time. Dick now going to run. He's across the line of scrimmage, slides to the 45-yard line. They'll put him down to the 46, so a gain of 4. Another third down short here for Rocky.
I'm surprised they didn't get that adjustment. Killian came across the set, but he ended up lining up on the line of scrimmage. Fortunately for them, Nathan Dick ran the ball. But, you know, if he throws the ball there, I think they had a uncovered downfield. or not a uncovered, and a covered downfield. Two wideouts to the wide side of the field here on the line of scrimmage.
Third down and four here for the Bears. Ball at the Montana Tech 46-yard line. Three receivers right, one to the left. Tech, four guys on the line of scrimmage. Dick going to swing it out here. Little screen pass. Turn it upfield. Very close. Now good second effort. That should be first down yardage. I believe Selgren. Nope, actually not Selgren that time. It's his back and Wilcox. So Wilcox will move the chains here for the Battling Bears. So a nice series as of right now here for the Bears.
Three receivers to the wide side of the field here. They all had hat on hat. They ran the back flare. Dick made the right decision, got the ball to his back, and everybody maintained their block long enough for his running back to get the first down.
First down and 10 here at the Montana Tech 41-yard line. Tech shows blitz again. Wilcox goes in motion. Nathan Dick, flare out, gets it out across the 35, down to the 33-yard line. That's going to be a gain of 9. So they're really spreading the field out here. Pass complete there to Trey Henry. And that's going to be very close to first down yardage again. Nathan Dick, 2 for 2 through the air.
Throws the ball a lot like, what was the Southern Oregon? Southern Oregon quarterback Dodge.
Yep, Austin Dodge.
Austin Dodge, that's who Nathan Dick reminds me of. Yep. Austin Dodge was an outstanding player in this conference. Dick's a lot like him. Maybe a little bit of a smaller frame, but quick release and throws a real tight ball.
Second and one, two receivers on each side of the formation. Nathan Dick gets the snap, handoff to his tailback, trying to fight to the line of scrimmage. Second effort probably got him there. Originally, it looked as though Wilcox was going to get shut down.
Looks like they're going to be about maybe a yard or a half yard short here, looking at third and short.
There you go. That will be the case. Boy, it looked like he was down maybe a half yard to a full yard behind the line of scrimmage. Made a nice little spin move. Third and short. You'd have to assume two down territory more than likely here. Back moves to the left side. Two receivers on both sides of the formation. Hand off Dick. And a first down, diving forward with the rock has been Rooney. Rooney out of Hamilton will move the chains here for the Battling Bears.
Montana Tech didn't really give a short yardage front there. They just had a three-man surface. The linebackers were at a more natural level. And so, and not saying they gave away the first down, they brought a little bit of pressure, but Rocky had the right call, inside zone, off the right side, able to move the sticks.
And it feels like with a quarterback like Nathan Dick, that's just respect with what he can do out of that scenario. Three receivers, two backs. Dick will play action, steps up in the pocket, has a huge gap to run. Across the 25-20, cutback 15, down inside the 10 to the 8. There you go, Nathan Dick, a big run. He'll pick up 20 with the feet. And that is first and goal here for the Battling Bears.
Naoki Harmer's kicking himself a little bit. Coming up from safety, you know, Montana Tech laid back a little bit. He had a chance at Dick there and missed. You know, when the opposing quarterbacks, you know, when the opposing quarterback gets on the loose and he's not going into a slide, you get there and you punish. And Harmer knew he had a chance there and just kind of missed.
First and goal from the 9. Nathan Dick out of the shotgun here for the Bears. First drive here of the ball game. Handoff will go right side and it goes nowhere. Wilcox with the carry. Wilcox is stood up immediately by that Digger D. And Brandon Morley, one of the first to step up and make contact.
I like Rocky's game plan so far. You know, they've mixed up the run and the pass. You know, everything they've thrown has been, you know, kind of zone pickers, you know, choice routes, stop routes and stuff like that. They got a plan, and it looks like a real patient plan against this Montana Tech defense.
I think patience is the right word. Three receivers left. Nathan Dick out of the shotgun, second and goal just inside the 10. Looking left the whole way. Nathan Dick goes to the back pylon and almost intercepted. What a play out there at corner that time.
Not Washington.
That's my first guess. Has to be Washington, so great job there by Washington to step in. He actually jumped that route. He gets in front of the receiver. Watch that. He gets a hand up on it.
I can't get that
almost
number.
Calls
is, that,
it in.
Is that zero? Or is that Angel Sanchez back in the lineup?
Sanchez is back.
Oh, that's
back
who it
in.
Is. That's exactly who it is. He's back. You know, he missed that Carroll College game, and we were really impressed with Sanchez the last couple of years. So really good position on that ball.
So that'll bring up third and goal just inside the 10. Two receivers each way. One back at home is Wilcox. Nathan Dick out of the shotgun. Good snap, looking left. He has all day. Across the middle, route is caught. No, it's knocked clean. Great job in the secondary knocking that one down.
It
looks like Harmer.
I think that time it was Washington. Is that five?
We'll get a look here. I think it was Harmer as they go to the instant replay here.
We get instant replay.
Look at that action. So throw to the back of the end zone. And I believe that's going to bring the kicking unit in. I want to say it was Harmer. I'm probably wrong.
Was this a great play regardless?
That's the deal.
You know, that ball is, you know, it was a great route. The execution was perfect, but just a great defensive play.
So a 26-yard attempt near the center of the field. Snap and hold are good. The kick is up, and the kick is through. So the Battling Bears will score on their opening possession as they lead 3-0 over Montana Tech. A great opening drive, and the Bears are on the board first. Montana Tech will get the football back, ladies and gentlemen. We'll take a break. We're back here to Bob Green Field right after this.
Media. Time out.
Montana Tech is a place for opportunity and innovation, where determined doers thrive. Montana Tech Athletics is committed to providing transformative experiences for our students while striving for excellence across all programs. Our goal is to enrich and expand our programs and facilities while delivering the one-on-one attention and family environment that's a hallmark for Montana Tech. As we look forward, we're excited to embrace growth and are driven to provide a championship experience for our student athletes, our campus, our fans, and our Butte community. We have a vision for the future of Montana Tech Athletics and cannot wait to share more throughout the season.
Hey, welcome back here once again to the campus of Montana Tech as we are at Bob Green Field Alumni Coliseum. The Digs doing battle with the Bears. Thanks for joining us here on a Saturday. A really nice drive by Rocky. 11 plays, 65 yards. Five first downs in that drive. They threw it seven times. And just a really good-looking drive. Like you said, they had a game plan. They stuck to it, and they get 3 points in their opening possession.
Yeah, the plan is patience, no doubt about it. They know Montana Tech's playing really good, sound defensive football, so they've done their homework, and they found what the defense might give them.
So they return out across the 15. Little stutter step there out to nearly the 20-yard line. So the Digger offense will see our first possession here today as Montana Tech will be led out by Jet Campbell and company. Let's talk about them here for just a moment. Montana Tech, Jet Campbell just having an outstanding season. 31 of 50 through the air, 62% of his completions. He's thrown for 467 yards, three touchdowns, and as I mentioned earlier, no interceptions as of yet. Blake Counts, the leading running back, 38 carries, 175 yards. And so from there, he's averaging 87.5 yards a game, and he is the leading rusher in the Frontier Conference right now at 87.5. Out of the shotgun, Jet Campbell. Drop route underneath to Hoffman. Hoffman, boy, the corner, he made a great move, and the corner was going deep, and Hoffman squares it out across the 30. That's going to move the chains.
You know, we've seen Montana Tech a lot of times start out with Hoffman down the sideline, you know, kind of a go route or some kind of a double move thing. And you got a corner there for Rocky. And it looks like Braille Lipford gave him all the respect in the world. Hoffman read it, and Campbell read it. Easy completion.
Two receivers tight to the right side, one here on the near side. Out of the shotgun, play action. Campbell wants to throw it. Pump fake once. He's looking for the deep ball now. He has a man downfield off the fingertips as Hoffman lays out for it, just unable to come up with it. So there you go. Instead of on the first down, they do it on the next first down.
Well, and that's, you know, they had Hoffman on kind of a double move. You know, if you were listening to Gruden, he'd call that a jerk route. That's a corner post. We used to call it a bolt route. You know, he came from the inside slot and stomped on the corner for a couple steps and then went, you know, he changed direction twice, right? And so that we used to call that a kind of a lightning bolt route. They tried to get him. Rocky read it pretty well. Campbell put the ball the only place he could yep. put it. It would have been a tough catch for Hoffman, but Hoffman would expect to make that grab.
Out of the shotgun again. Handoff will go up the middle, bouncing right as Blake gets a hand up, trying to get the stiff arm out in front. It's going to be a gain of two. Ball comes out. No whistle. Rocky's going to take it to the house. Rocky is going to get the turnover as Prince Johnson, the linebacker, that ball comes out. Prince Johnson gets it, and he'll take it to the house. As Rocky will go up 9-0.
I jinxed the counts a little bit in the pregame, talking about he doesn't cough up the ball. But you saw him meet the line of scrimmage, and then he tried to escape out the left side, and he was working quite a bit trying to stiff arm the defender. Rocky got a lot of guys to the ball, and sometimes, you know, in the fight for yardage, you lose focus on holding on to the football, and that's probably what happened to Counts there.
So a turnover will go to Prince Johnson. He scoops and scores it. We have a man short here. That's so the first turnover of the year is a fumble return for a score.
It's quite the man they were missing, too.
No joke.
A 300-pounder.
So the kicking unit is in. Rocky, the PAT is blocked. Montana Tech trying to field it here. Jordan Washington grabs it, can't keep his feet. So it will go out of bounds. So the PAT is blocked. So Montana Tech will grab a little momentum back. But Rocky right now with a full head of steam. 8:03 left to play in the first half. The Battling Bears leading 9-0.
Looked like it was going to be 9-2 there real quick.
It really did. But it does get a little momentum here. So we'll see how that changes. So a big turnover in the first turnover of the year will go. And Rocky will get the scoop and score out of it.
Yeah, Montana Tech offensively just got to settle down. You know, you came out, ran a couple plays. Execution didn't look bad. You just have to be patient. You can't let that big swing in momentum off the fumble recovery for the touchdown for Rocky dictate what you're going to start this game in. You just got to come back to the plan. It's early in this game, 8 minutes left in the first quarter. You can't panic offensively.
So as we come back out here, Montana Tech will try it again. So right now, Rocky on their opening possession, kicked the field goal after going 11 plays, 65 yards. Montana Tech turns it over in their opening possession. They'll re-rack it and try it again here. So the kicking unit for Rocky getting ready to stomp it away.
Shelby Coyote kicking off, Wyatt Bresvin.
Okay. Thank
you.
There you go. There's always a few out there.
I gotta love the Coyotes.
This one high end over end kick into the end zone and will be knelt there. So the Digger offense will get another go here.
Wyatt also two deep on their defensive roster at linebacker.
So the kicking unit puts Montana Tech into the end zone. So here the Digs will get us and rolling one more time.
And he's a one deep this series. He's staying on the field.
There you go. So the Digger offense huddling up, chatting things over here, trying to calm down just a little bit. So again, Jet Campbell, leading passer in the Frontier Conference. Blake Counts, leading rusher in the Frontier Conference. We'll see if this offense can get moving here. Opening quarter, 8 minutes left to play. Rocky leading 9-0. And Jet Campbell, one back, two receivers to his left. Looks like Hoffman by himself up on the top. Out of the shotgun, handoff going to go to Blake. Blake straight ahead, bounces across the 28, out near the 30-yard line. That's going to be a pickup, looks like five on first down.
Good gain on first down, just inside zone off the left side. Counts saw the quick wind back, got behind his offensive front, was able to pick up 5 yards, but more importantly, did you see we don't always see that out of Counts, both hands on the ball. Both hands on the ball, and a credit to that offensive staff coming right back to it.
Yeah. So that'll bring up second and five here for the Digs. There's already some chirping going on. These two have been rather vocal with one another through the last couple of years.
That goes back about 40 years.
They'll run the fly motion, handoff, turning it upfield, out near first down yardage.
Yeah, they get Torgerson motion across the set, a little fly motion, quick handoff. Torgerson's able to turn the corner and cut up and get really close to a first down here. It looks like Montana Tech's looking at third and one.
That's a play that I do expect to see a little bit more today. They did run that fly motion and even a lot of even kind of screen passes against Eastern Oregon. They didn't bring it out against Carroll, but they kind of do expect to see it here today.
Rocky, after the Carroll game, will be leery of a little play action here, but I would guess this ball is going to go right in Count's belly.
Third and one. They'll move both tight ends here to the bottom of your screen. Out of the shotgun, Jet Campbell. Blake Counts will get the ball. Counts tried to pick his lane, and he gets tripped up. Nice job defensively that time as Cade Reynolds, the freshman out of Alabama, will make the stop.
Cade Reynolds, a really good play. Got into the legs of Counts. You know, he meets him upstairs. He might lose that battle, but smart defender. He goes low and rakes the knees of Blake Counts as he's trying to pick a hole there. Really nice defensive play in the backfield.
Fourth down and one. Punting unit comes in here for the Digs. And they signal us good to go. So the Rocky defense will stand them up. And now it looks like we're giving the whistle and a go-ahead. So Rocky's offense going to get the football back here. 6:05 remaining in the opening quarter. Rocky leading 9-0. Low kick. Tight spiral. Bounces at the 25. Fielded. Ball comes out. Loose on the ground. Picked up Montana Tech. Picked up inside the 5. Down to the 2-yard line. The bullet gets down there.
We'll see where they mark this. So if that ball was muffed, I don't know if you can advance it. They got the official standing at the 12-yard line. Or if they deem it controlled and fumbled, the ball will be rested at the 1 or 2 yard line. So we'll see where they mark this. They may rule it a muff, and Montana Tech might start this series out about the 12-yard
line. That's where it looks like. Jaden McNeil, I believe, with the stop. McNeil, just an incredible athlete out of Flathead, was their quarterback for the Flathead Braves through the Kyle Sampson era up there, and has been special teams ace in getting more reps and more reps in his career here. So the Digs with the football.
Counts out, and Winterburn here in at tailback.
First and 10 from the 12, Winterburn.
Montana Tech's got a condensed, three receivers to the right side, tight end, two receivers to the right side, but everything's bunched and condensed.
Out of the shotgun, Jet Campbell dropping back, step across the middle, and a good defensive play that time. Linebacker reaches across as Zach, or actually the other side of that was Nolan McCafferty.
I was going to mention, when they condense their set, when they get in tight, you know, whether it's trips or tight doubles, they really like to throw out of that set.
5:48 remaining here in the opening quarter. We've seen some big momentum swings already here in this opening quarter. Montana Tech going to try and take advantage of one here. Both teams with a turnover. Rocky scored a touchdown on the one they took away. We'll see if the Digs can answer. Jet Campbell, second and 10. Man in motion, left side. Wyatt Alexander, handoff going to go to the tailback across the 10, fighting down near the 7-yard line. As with the run was Winterburn. Winterburn, he'll get about 5 on that. Brings up 3rd down and 5 here for the Digger offense.
Yeah, Winterburn gave him a little bit different look. You know, I don't know if that was kind of supposed to be, you know, Montana Tech had double set. At the snap of the football, everybody was in tight. Winterburn showed the stretch. He showed a little bit of wide and got it cut up and found himself a little space to pick up 5 yards.
5:18 remaining here in this opening quarter. Rocky leading 9-0.
Pretty respectable for an ex-quarterback.
Third down and 5. Split back, something we don't see out of Tech all that often. One receiver on each side. Campbell fade route to the corner. Hoffman trying to find some space. And he in the corner out there just battling. Nice job defensively. Lipford out there to make the pass go incomplete.
Lipford's a little undersized out there standing against Hoffman, but he made a great play on that ball. Got his eyes to the quarterback at the last second and got his upfield arm across Hoffman's eyes and got that ball knocked away.
And we've seen him challenge the other side of that already. He and Hoffman have already had a couple battles here in this opening quarter, so Lipford really has come to battle in this ball game.
I used to love that as an offensive coach, and I would keep coming to that guy. You know, I always trust, you know, I always tell you that if I could go do it again, I'd trust my guy even more. Yeah. Against that guy.
A 25-yard attempt is up and good for the Digs. So Montana Tech gets on the board. So they get 3 points off of the turnover. Rocky got 6 points off of their turnover. And we'll see how this one shakes out. 9-3. The Battling Bears up over Montana Tech. We're here at Alumni Coliseum. We have a timeout, so we'll take one. We're back right after this. We'll be right back.
something different here, in the air, and in the attitude. It's the tight-knit community, complemented by bigger thinking and even bigger innovation. It's high-tech labs with sweeping Rocky Mountain views. It's a place where research, innovation, and ideas are matched by an understanding of why it all matters in the first place. Here at Montana Tech, you can realize your potential, fuel your passion, and find your path. Join us.
Hey, welcome back here once again to the campus of Montana Tech, Bob Greenfield at Alumni Coliseum, as Montana Tech gets their first points of the afternoon. Rocky leading 9-3. Yeah, the Digs will kick off here. Frontier Conference action. Tech 1-2 undefeateds left here in the conference.
Boring score, but not a boring game.
No, long way removed from that. If the momentum swings that we've seen in the first quarter continue, this is going to get crazy. So the Digs will kick off here. And Rocky, who had an outstanding opening possession, they had five first downs in that possession, and moved the ball 65 yards, really spread the offense out, and they did what you expect out of a Nathan Dick-type offense, where you've got to be leery of the run all times. He's going to put the ball on target, and we'll see if they're able to manufacture that here. Deep kickoff again, going to go through the uprights. That should be another 3 points.
You kidding
me? The kickoff is good. It cleared the bar.
There's no wind.
Into a wind. No, look at the flag over on the Gallus frame. We've got wind out of the south.
Look at him. He's all, kicker's all fired up. Lowry's all fired up. I don't blame him.
No, that was outstanding. Lowry absolutely boomed that into some wind and puts it in across the crossbar.
That's good information to have if this game comes down to a field goal.
I asked Coach Sampson what his feelings were, and he said inside 45, they feel pretty comfortable with him letting go. First down at 10, one back, trips receivers left set up, handoff to the tailback, and not much there, maybe a yard.
James Newby getting on the line of scrimmage there and causing a pile along with big number 95. I haven't called his number. Zeke Frommel. Is that how you say it? Is it Frommel?
I believe so. Feel,
you know, it's bad enough to butcher opponents' names, but I'd hate to butcher Tech names.
There you go. Second and nine. Dick out of the shotgun again. Tech puts four on the defensive front. Rocky looks to the sideline after the hard count.
See, I think that should be a penalty. Now, even though their knuckles aren't in the dirt, Tech jumped. They didn't come across the line of scrimmage.
They stood up.
And they stood up and reacted. I think that should be a penalty.
Second down and nine. Now we're going to get flags aplenty.
There you go.
And Rocky will be called with five. Head linesman Ron Haskett here in the booth, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I was an offensive coach, a defensive player. I despise D linemen. You got to give them a break at some time. There's a reason their coach walks around practice with a football on a rope.
There are times where I feel like you speak to me as though I'm your therapist, not your cohort in the
booth.
Well,
I do confide in you quite a bit. You're the voice of reason in this booth.
No, this one back here is our voice of reason. Second and 14 here for the Battling Bears. One back, and he will release. Blitz coming. Nathan Dick stands, batted down at the line of scrimmage. That's the deal.
That's Trumbull. Had a little bit of a stunt. Trumbull came upfield and was working inside. Got his eyes up. Knew he wasn't going to get to Dick. Got his eyes up and got that ball knocked away. Great play.
An important question I had for Coach Sampson this week is, you know, you look at Nathan Dick. He does stand in the pocket. He'll deliver. But the one thing that Coach Sampson understands all too well is he is undersized at quarterback. And I asked him, you know, your defensive line, your linebackers, in a game like this, do you spend a lot of time in practice working on getting your hands up and trying to bat down balls or even just get hands in the passing lane? And he's like, yes, that has been a huge factor here this week.
Well, we used to remind them all the time in the secondary.
Yeah.
Remind them to get their hands up because those are easy interceptions. You know, you get a deflected ball, a ball in the air.
Downfield, one-on-one, and that one's going to be knocked out. Boy, again, a lot of physicality between the receiver and the corner.
Was it Angel?
That looked like Sanchez. And that will be the case. Sanchez making another big play out there And they're letting these guys play. We've seen it on both sides. The receivers and corners have been in some hand battles here in the first quarter, and the officials right now are letting it go.
I really like Angel Sanchez. He's not only a really good cover guy, but he's physical. And when he arrives to the football, he's a great hitter. You know, I don't think Montana Tech puts a defender on the field that doesn't hit real well. But going back a year or two, Sanchez will bring the wood.
That he is. Fourth down and long here, so the punting unit is in. The Bears will punt it away for the first time today. Wobbly kick, bounces at the 37, single hops, and trying to find some room is Torgerson. Torgerson, little head fake, and he'll be grabbed by his high collar. Almost felt like we might get a horse collar there. He'll be taken down at the 28-yard line. Nice job, special teams, getting downfield that time. Matthew McGrain.
Being a great punt returner can be kind of a curse, you know, because you always expect big things. Sometimes you just have to kind of settle that the coverage unit did their job and go get what you can. I think Torgerson had a good chance there for, you know, maybe 4 or 5 yard return. You know, sometimes you just got to kind of take that.
Yeah. 339.
Try to make something out of nothing. You end up losing yardage, you know, and
it'd be hard. 3:39 left to play here in the opening quarter. Looks like a timeout on the field. We'll go ahead and keep it here for a minute.
I'm assuming. I wasn't a punt returner.
Well, no, but, even as a punt returner, almost all
Rocky Mountain Credit Union, we call this community
returner,
home,
you have to think
just
you
like
can take
you.
It to the house.
That's
every time
why we
you
take a locally
and
focused
sometimes
approach
that's what you
kind of
have to get over. Is
your financial
maybe
success is our primary goal.
5, 10
whether you're refinancing your home, buying a car, starting a business, or just need help with your checking or savings account, we'll give you the financial tools you need.
We talk about that all the time.
At Rocky Mountain Credit Union,
when you're playing a good defense, sometimes 3 yards and a cloud of dust is about as good as
you're going to do. We're here for all life's events.
And
big
you
and
have
small.
To be patient.
Stop
you know,
by your local branch or visit rmcu.net.
It's kind of that same scenario. You know, sometimes it's, you know, they did their job. Let's go get what we can and get our offense on the field.
So Montana Tech's offense.
Thank you.
We'll
this year's day one
here.
Giving
Jack
event
Campbell
at Montana Tech raised over $323,000 over 2 days from 611 donors. A special shout out to all of our Digger Athletic donors, to the Digger Legacy Fund, where 123 donors provided $55,000 to support our students and grow our programs. Thank you to everyone who was a part of day one 2022. We can't wait to see what we can do in 2023.
You know, he's good, but I think once he got to the NFL, I think he kind of became one of the most underrated players in
Agreed.
The NFL.
Yep.
He is,
I agree.
It is unbelievable how good a football player he is. He's not real huge.
Well,
but,
he doesn't
know,
have
he's
a big
playmaker.
Mouthpiece.
Yeah.
First down and 10, Montana Tech with the football.
We're talking about Honey Badger.
Let's just move
I love
on.
It.
Two receivers left, one to the right. Jet Campbell looking left the whole way to Hoffman across the 36. He'll fight his way out to the 40.
Good luck.
Good strength by Hoffman.
Is that Lipford?
Yep, Lipford
was
on him again.
Lipford up there. You know, again, giving Hoffman a little room. But, you know, what you don't realize about Hoffman, if you just listen to us and don't watch him, he's about 6'4", 6'5". He's 215 and moves like, one of the little fast, the little 5'9", 5'10 guys. So he's tough to handle.
Second and two. So it's almost free down there. Do you take a shot on second and two, or do you just move the chains and get comfortable?
You know, they might. I would think if they were looking for pass protection, I don't know what kind of pass protector Winterburn is.
Hand off going to go to Winterburn. He gets past one defender, not going to get past the second. Held on hard, and he will be driven out of bounds. So he'll lose a yard.
Yeah.
Nice job defensively that time, catching the edge. Looked like he had a lane there initially, and then it was shut off real quick-like. So third down now for Montana Tech. Third down and three here with a loss of one.
Rocky's doing a good job up front. The defensive, in their odd front there, they're taking on blocks and they're, controlling the line of scrimmage right now. And, they're clearly disrupting what Tech wants to do running the ball.
Yeah, they're doing a nice job down there in the trenches.
Now you see a five-man surface here.
Third down and three. Out of the shotgun again. They're going to run screen pass out to Hoffman. Stiff arm, and he'll lean forward, gets first down yardage.
Hoffman just has to fall down for three, as long as he is. But a good – that's just RPO. Off the left side, they look like they were heavy, but that's just RPO. Campbell made the right call, flipped it out to Hoffman, just one-on-one with Lipford.
Third catch of the afternoon for Hoffman. Brings up first down and 10 here for the Digs.
They're setting up a double move, no doubt, with Hoffman here. A lot of this quick out, quick hit stuff. They're setting up something for a downfield throw.
Two receivers to the bottom of your screen. Hoffman the deepest. has time. Campbell now flushed out of the pocket to his right. Steps up. Campbell in trouble. Spins away from one. He's off to the races. Still looking to throw. Now he'll run across midfield. Jet Campbell down through the 40. He'll get down to the 38-yard line. What a run by Jet Campbell.
Campbell went from panicked quarterback to thinking he was O.J. Simpson. he made a couple great moves there out around the right side, cleared back, got upfield to his left, and found some open daylight. And the next thing you know, he thought he was Jed Fike or Nolan Saracini. Oh, that was funny.
First down and 10, great run by Jet Campbell. He'll get the play call up to the line of scrimmage. First and 10 from the Rocky 38-yard line. The Digs trailing 9-3. 1:50 left to play here in the first. Man comes in motion as Torgerson. Torgerson, play action. And a blitz coming. Stands in, delivers downfield. That's going to go incomplete.
Had him. Had him on the deep cross. Hoffman and Rocky covered that pass well. You know, they faked the fly motion. They faked the back on the inside zone. Hoffman ran a good route. Campbell just put it a little too far in front of him.
And he stood in the pocket as long as he could before he was leveled as Ethan Hurst came on the blitz.
He got a lot of time there on an untouched pass rusher.
Yeah, he really did.
He got a lot of time to wait for Hoffman to get himself open.
So an injured player down on the field here for Montana Tech. 1:41 left to play here in this opening quarter. Rocky leading 9-3.
Looks like an old front guy, I think.
Let's see what we have here score-wise. Northern and Western are scoreless at the end of one.
Northern Lights are running wild?
There you go, and Northern Lights are running wild. That's the only score I've seen thus far. I'll try and get the others. We'll get you updated.
Excuse me, it's not Max Anderson. I saw him walk to the huddle here on the sideline. It's kind of tough to see what they're dealing with here. He hates to speculate. And all that stuff, but it's always good to have an idea what might have got banged up.
Yeah. I'm just going to continue to look down through here real quickly. Soon-to-be Frontier Conference member Arizona Christian is at Louisiana Christian today. We'll kind of start, obviously, paying a little bit more attention to their year as we continue. Let's see here.
Yeah, it's Carson Schumann walking off under his own power. Got a little bit of limp on the right side. Might have tweaked a knee or an ankle. But the way he's walking, I would expect him to get a little treatment on the sideline and be back in the ball game.
College of Idaho is at Southern at 3 o'clock our time. And as we mentioned, Western and Northern are scoreless.
Little guy.
Little guy.
Little guy. 6'2", 300. Just a little guy. Dad was a Carroll Saint, I believe.
Okay.
Bo Schumann, I think, is his name. Might have played against me. I can't remember.
Second down and 10 here for the Digs.
I got a lot of concussions back then.
Well, that leather helmet didn't help either. Two receivers right, one to the left. Hoffman goes in motion. He'll stop. And the handoff going to go to Blake Counts. Counts not going to get through the line of scrimmage again. Rockies up front, D, doing a nice job plugging gaps. There defensively is Fletcher.
Yeah, Jaden Fletcher, he's running that down from the backside, playing outside linebacker, but he chased that inside zone down from the backside.
Third down and 10 here for the Digs. So, again, we'll keep you updated on the other scores as we continue here. But Montana Tech having a tough time running the football as of right now.
They're sending Counts out wide to the right, way wide to the right. Hoffman and Winterburn in here tight.
Yeah, Winterburn's.
Something we haven't seen. I don't know if we're going to maybe see a little somewhat of a gimmick here.
Third down and 10. Jed Campbell, three-step drop. Now he's flushed to his left. Campbell going to run with it across the line of scrimmage, across the 30. And he'll be about a yard, maybe 2 yards shy of the first down marker.
He's close. This is going to be a decision for this
We've got a flag down. This is probably holding where that flag sits. We'll wait to hear from our officials. And it is. So the holding penalty on what was a nice run, obviously gets an assist, and that's going to come back 10. What was third and 10? We'll come back to the 48-yard line.
Game's been pretty clean so far. Rocky got pressure quick that time on Campbell. He didn't get much of a chance to look at what they were trying to develop there and made a good decision. You know, sometimes the decision is to just get out of there a little quicker. Campbell did that. Unfortunately, they had the hold in the backfield, but I like the quick decision-making that time out of Jet Campbell.
Third down and 20 here for the Digs. As we await the whistle and the go-ahead, three receivers up top, one to the bottom of your screen. Hoffman by himself here at the bottom of your screen.
Rocket's going to give a four-man rush. Offensively, you just have to protect. Give him 3 seconds and see what can surface here.
Mickle packages in. They'll even drop a linebacker. Jet Campbell stands downfield. Pass is caught. He'll get the penalty yards plus a few back. Torgerson hauls it in. That's a gain of 14.
They like that route out of Torgerson in the inside slot. That's just about a 10, 15-yard, like a choice route or a curl route. But they made a couple big completions and first downs to Torgerson in the game against Carroll that kept Carroll's offense off the field. I know Rocky, you know, they probably knew that was coming. But if you're a good route runner, you can sell that. You can sell a lot of things and still run that hook curl route.
Well, you're kind of in no man's land here, so the offense originally was out. Now Jet Campbell walking to the sideline to come chat with coach.
You know, we go back to that Carroll game. I thought they should have kicked Phil. Your kicker offer. Lowry just kicked one through the goalposts.
65 yards.
20, 25.
Actually, 75.
29 yards behind this. I give my kicker a shot. I kick the field goal.
Fourth down and seven. We have one quarter in the books. Rocky leading 9-3 here at Alumni Coliseum. We're back right after this.
The game.
Dude,
you're gonna score.
Man cave, lady lounges, whatever you call them, steals furniture out of exactly what you need to make your room come to life. Shop our Man Cave showroom today for ideas to upgrade your bar set, fireplace, TV, recliner, furniture set, and refrigerator. Steals furniture, making Man Caves happen for 87 years.
We're back here once again to the campus of Montana Tech. One quarter in the books, and the Battling Bears leading 9-3 over Montana Tech. A crazy first quarter, for goodness sake. A ton of different momentum shifts. We've seen one sustained drive, a couple turnovers.
Kick the field goal, Paul.
And the offense will stay out. Fourth down and eight. Man in motion, far left side. Three-step drop. Jet Campbell flushed out of the pocket, moving right. Campbell steps back. We're going to get a holding penalty. He's going to air it up downfield, and a huge hit. So we're going to get offsetting penalties here, I would assume. I believe we're going to get a holding penalty and then about nine pass interference penalties.
You know, the timing wasn't terrible on what the Rocky defender there did, but the Tech receiver clearly had to stop and change directions, and as he changed directions, he got clotheslined. Remember the old clothesline?
The old clothesline. Fourth down and eight. And we'll get our white hat here.
There are two fouls on play. They will offset. Holding.
So we got a holding against Tech.
Pass interference.
And pass interference. So we're going to get a replay of the down.
Here comes Schumann back into the game. Walked off with an injury. Carson Schumann.
He'll check back in. Fourth down and eight. The offense stays out. Blake counts the back. Torgerson you see there as well. Coach Sampson comes out. He'll bark out the play. We're going to get tight end right. Looks like three receivers left. A field goal attempt from here would be about 53 yards, right?
If you want to punch me, you can, but I still think it's the call.
Fourth down and seven. I'm just throwing it out there, that's all.
I know you are.
One back, three receivers. Man in motion across the formation. Wyatt Alexander. Three-step, late blitz coming. Picked up, Jet Campbell in trouble. He gets away from one defender, now running for his life. Campbell turns the corner, and we're going to get another holding penalty. Sliding across the 25, down to the 23, but this one's coming back.
Yeah, they're going to get Montana Tech offensive lineman. I think Caden Cross looked like he was trailing everybody. Do you think it's going to be holding or maybe?
I saw the Rocky defensive end put up the hands as though he couldn't, as though he was being held. But I'd be, yeah, this is going holding penalty against
offensive
the Dicks.
52, 10 yards. Still four
we
down.
Had a clean game, and now we've had penalty after penalty after penalty after
penalty. Yeah, big time. So that will change the unit out here. Special teams unit is huddled up. They'll march it back 10, and the punting unit will come in. So Montana Tech special teams unit has been pretty fantastic this year thus far. As back to punt it away is going to be almost already has four punts inside the 20 this year. And you'd have to assume this one going to be drilled down into one of the corners as well.
He'll either get there or almost get there.
Bad joke. Good night, everybody. Fourth down and long, almost. The punt snap is good. And a wobbly spiral, bounces at the 6, takes an Ortiger bounce sideways and is fielded there.
Good
knocked
play.
Down.
Good so play. That ball is starting to backtrack, and a really good play there by Winter. Is that Winterburn? Do we have two number threes on the roster?
Nope. So Winterburn, you think on the special teams, that would be the case. So Winterburn, special teams play, knocks it down, downs it at the 6-yard line. So Rocky's offense will look to get something going here. They have the one basic drive in this football game. Otherwise, it's been kind of back and forth in the middle.
Tech defense has settled into what they've been doing all year. You know, they're just they play fast, but they play really patient football too.
Nathan Dick out of the shotgun. One back, three receivers. Handoff goes to his tailback with a little running room. Gets through the first level across the 15 to the 18. Boy, you saw that gap develop. As with that carry, going to be Wilcox again, and Wilcox will move the chains. He just a little hop to his left once he got past that tackle gap, and off he went.
Yeah, sometimes, a play is that Rocky blocked that really well, right? So everybody hit their assignment. So that generally will leave one defender, past the line of scrimmage that's going to be one-on-one with that tailback. That time it was Windauer, who usually doesn't miss. He missed a shot at about 3 yards to get the tailback to the ground.
First down and 10, Nathan Dick out of the shotgun. Three receivers left, handoff going to go to Wilcox again. He gets hit behind the line of scrimmage. This time he just gets torn down to the ground.
Yeah, that's Wyatt or
my goodness.
James Newby. I can't.
He got hit initially, and then the entire defensive front was there to haul him down. My goodness, he got hit violently right at the line of scrimmage.
Oh, yeah, that's Wyatt. Wyatt came a little A-gap pressure that time, was in the backfield in a hurry. But he's playing good football.
That he is.
He's a little young last year. He had a fine year, but, we thought the Tech was maybe a little young at linebacker, but these two have really grown up, Windauer and Wyatt.
Second and 9. Play action, Dick to the one-on-one side. Pass complete. Boy, nice catch that time. The receiver on the edge. Tech got penalties for that 2 weeks ago.
Right.
And that's the one that we keep coming back to. The receiver that time makes that catch and puts the hand up, the first down marker. That's Trey Henry. Nice catch by Henry on the comeback route.
That's still the only school I've seen called on it since 2016.
They're going to run screen here on the near side. Pass is caught, and it's going to be a loss of 3. As they run screen here on the near side, Killian goes down to make the catch.
It used to be one of our creed when I coached wide receivers at Montana Tech. The only advice I ever gave those guys was never dive for a ball behind the line of scrimmage. The worst thing that can happen is you can catch it.
Yeah, like Derry.
Yeah.
Down you go, lose 4, loss, yeah. Nearly 5. Two receivers on each side of the formation. Rocky with the football. They lead 9-3. Trying to get some momentum rolling here in the second quarter. Tech showing blitz. Nathan Dick out of the shotgun. Dick looking left. Pass downfield. Complete across the 40 out to the 44. Boy, the thing that has made Rocky's offense churn today is their offensive line's been fantastic. Tech is not getting any pressure to move Nathan Dick out of the pocket.
They're protecting when they need to protect. Just a 3-man rush from Montana Tech there gave Nathan Dick plenty of time. And what else they're doing? They're running zone routes really well. They're finding windows, leaving an open space between the quarterback and the receiver. That time Matthew McGrain just ran a good choice route, found the window, and Dick hit him right on the spot.
Another first down here for the Battling Bears. So that will bring him up to the line of scrimmage here. Nathan Dick, play action. Five-step drop. He's going to air it up right side. One-on-one down the sideline. Overthrow and incomplete. So that one goes out of play. He was looking downfield for Killian again.
Washington in good coverage that time.
So Nathan Dick, 7 of 11 on the day. He's thrown for 53 yards.
Tech got a little pressure that time. They brought a little bit of heat. And you'll notice Nathan Dick is getting rid of the ball in a hurry. Even there, you know, he waited for a go route, but he's not giving it more than 2 seconds back there.
Yeah, he is really tough to get pressure on. Trips receivers all to the top of your screen. Tight end at the bottom. Nathan Dick looking at a four-man defensive front presented by Tech. Long snap count. Dick, play action. He's going to go to his tight end here on the near side. And being shoved out of bounds at the 50 is going to be Simon. Mr. Simon.
Yeah, Simon, you know, at tight end, you get out there and you go head-to-head with a cornerback. You usually think, yeah, I'll get the best of this battle. But Washington's no joke from Montana Tech. 5'11", 175 pounds. But I tell you what, he brings it. He is a hitter, and he met Simon and didn't give an inch.
Third down and five. Tech almost getting across the neutral zone there quickly. James Newby picked him up and brought him back. Third and five. Two receivers on each side of the formation for Nathan Dick. Tech looking to make a stop here. Out of the shotgun.
Tech's bringing a little pressure.
Here comes the blitz. Dick stands in the pocket, delivers downfield. Pass complete across the 40, 35. Nice reception. Nice move after the fact. As with the reception again is Killian Jr. And that is his second catch of the day, and that'll move the chains here for the Battling Bears. So, again, another nice drive here for the Bears.
Rocky Whiteout's doing a good job. They're getting good upfield pressure. They're getting the defense on their heels, and they're sawing off their curl routes, their in routes, their stop routes, and they're getting the separation they need, and Dick's finding them.
This drive started back at their 6-yard line. One back, two receivers up top, and play action again. Nathan Dick drops back to throw. He wants the deep ball. And that one's going to fall incomplete. Overthrown that time. That'll bring up second and 10.
Between the college game and the NFL game, you can see collisions beyond 5 yards in the college game, and you saw it there. You saw, I think it was Angel Sanchez. You know, there was a collision at about the 25-yard line, and but the ball wasn't released yet, you know. So that's all good in the college game. It's not good in the NFL game.
Back up, second down and 10 here for Rocky. Again, putting together a nice drive here. Nathan Dick out of the shotgun. Dick is 8 of 13 through the air. Two receivers on each side. Back goes in motion, and he is going to go with it. Nathan Dick, quarterback keeper across the 30 to the 29. Good That'll tackle. Bring up third down and four here. Design quarterback run that whole time.
Ben Windauer at inside backer took his pass drop, recognized the quarterback escape. They tried to run the inside linebackers out of there with the back flare that time. Windauer's got to be conscious of the back flare in the flat, but Dick kind of gave the tailback his look and then tried to run up the middle, but Windauer didn't bite, came up and made the tackle in space.
Third and four, quickly to the line of scrimmage. Three receivers all the way up top. Nathan Dick, handoff to his tailback, trying to get the edge, and he's not going to get there. Taken down here on the near side. Big-time play, Montana Tech, is Ben Windauer again. That's going to be a loss of two.
Windauer, another tackle for loss. He's been really good football this year. He's grown into a heck of a good inside linebacker. We saw him miss early in this series, and that stuff eats at those linebackers. They don't like to miss. They don't like to ever miss, and he's made two or three exceptional plays since.
So the offense will stay out here for the Bears. Fourth down and six.
Yeah, you got to be conscious of stop routes here, curl routes and stuff like that. That's where Rocky's had the most success, is in the curl to hook zone.
Two backs, three receivers. Nathan Dick drops back, stands, gets his tight end, and that's first down yardage plus some. Big hit delivered to the 20, but that will be first down yardage here as once again they go to Andrew Simon, and Simon's going to move the chains.
Wait, Dick hasn't been real accurate on the deep ball today, but everything else has been on the spot.
On spot. Yeah, just been absolutely on the money. First and 10. Nathan Dick now 9 of 15 through the air. Quick hitter and handoff to the tailback. And trying to fight forward, he'll get two on forward progress. And I assume we'll see that change as well. But anytime Rocky has gotten to the line of scrimmage with a quick snap, they have run the football. Yeah. And we've only seen it like three times, but with that certainly I would assume we'll change here as we go. But that has been the playbook thus far.
Tyler Little got really good penetration that time early, changed the direction of the running back and slowed him down. He didn't necessarily make the tackle for loss, but he made the play in the backfield.
Rocky leading 9-3. Split backs, three receivers. Out of the shotgun, Nathan Dick. Tailback in motion. They're going to get him the football. And across the 15, great burst of speed down to the goal line and in for six. With the touchdown, going to be Zaire Wilcox. Boy, Wilcox really threw you off. He was fast. He got to the edge, cleared the corner, and got in for six. Now we have a flag down way after the play was done.
You're going to get some unsportsmanlike type stuff in the end zone, you know, maybe excessive celebration of some sort in the end zone. Good play, though. They just got the mismatch they wanted. They had a quick on an inside linebacker out there in the flat, and the quick had a step, and it was over.
Just absolutely gone. So it looks as though the 15-yard penalty will come on the kickoff. But right now, Rocky up 15-3, 8:55 left to play here in this opening half.
Zaire Wilcox, 5'8", 180 pounds, sophomore out of Lecanto, Florida. But, yeah, he just won the sprint to the sideline, was able to turn the corner, got met at the goal line, but was able to hit and spin into the end zone.
Montana Tech only three first downs so far here in the first half, trailing 15-3. The Battling Bears, time of possession, see if I can find it. That has to be insanely one-sided here. Yeah, feels like they have had the ball the entire first half thus far.
Quarterback doing the holding here. Nathan Dick doing the holding on this special teams.
So Nathan Dick engineers a 94-yard drive for 6 points, and the PAT is blocked again. Back-to-back blocks on the PAT.
Look like Morris.
That's a big-time play. So Montana Tech blocks their second PAT.
Excuse me. That's Grant O'Rourke. Yeah, we called his name quite a bit against Carroll College. Deep front guy. So 6'1", 255 pounder from Fromberg. He looks a little taller than 6'1 to me.
8:55 left to play here in the first half. Montana Tech's offense looking to get something going. That was a great drive by Rocky again. They come out with a touchdown. 15-3 our score. It's not exactly a pull tab you would jump up and down about the opening.
Obviously, these eight-man, you know, there's a lot of good eight-man skill guys and fun guys, but when they get to the next level and they play really well, like at the college level, I always go back and think,
if you decide that engineering is what you want to do, there's no better place.
You know, because O'Rourke is big. He's, 255. He's big. He can run. Obviously athletic. Can jump. And just to watch that guy on an eight-man field must have been awesome.
Grew up on a so farm, thus far, Rocky,
well, turned out
with
years.
Shows here 13 minutes of possession time. Rocky has 11 first downs. Montana Tech
felt more like family, and they really wanted me to come and be a part of it.
These couple of touchdown drives from Rocky are taking a lot of clock. They're keeping the Tech offense off the field.
Rare.
They're keeping them out of sync when they do come back onto the field. And it gets a little frustrating. You can get panicked as an offensive staff thinking, we got to go out there and score. I mean, we got so much stuff we worked on all week. We haven't got to any of it. And, sometimes you can feel a little hurried. But you have to remember, there's just over 2.5 quarters of football here. And you just got to stick to the game plan. What did you plan on coming in? What's worked? What hasn't worked?
Montana Tech right now, 17 offensive plays for 87 yards. Rocky has run 30 offensive plays for 167. And the kickoff will go back to the 20-yard line.
Should get good field position here. This is you spent a lot of time on kick return during the week. This is where you have to execute. But most importantly, no penalties, no pushes in the back, no holds. Get your assignment and give your return guys, Torgerson and McNeil, a chance.
So, again, the kickoff at the 20-yard line. Personal foul call after the timeout. So, Rocky will kick off back at their 20, and as Haskey mentioned, should have good field position here for the Digs. End-over-end kick high. The return will start at the 22. And to the center of the field it goes. Now back out on the left side. Looks like McNeil with it across the 40 out to the 43. So Tech will get good field position. And Montana Tech's offense will come out and look to get some momentum here. They really haven't had much in the way of momentum yet here in the first half, and we'll see if their offense can get something going. No running game right now. I mean, the Rocky defensive front has gotten pressure. They've moved Jet Campbell out of the pocket quite a bit, and they have completely shut down Montana Tech's attempt run of the football.
Tech's most success has come, granted there's been a couple holds, but when plays have broke down and Campbell's got out on the loose. You know, they throw the ball somewhat effectively, but had nothing on the ground game so far. And, you know, going back to that kickoff, that's a purpose pitch out of Bresvin. He isn't going to try and kick it low and hard as far as he can. He put a lot of air under it and allowed his kick cover team to do what they could to keep Montana Tech on the other side of the 50-yard line.
First down and 10 here for the Digs. Jet Campbell has one back, two receivers left here in motion. Wyatt Alexander. Handoff, play action, Campbell rolling right, airs it up downfield, behind his man, looking for Hoffman at midfield. That one will fall incomplete. So that one falls incomplete.
Pretty quick pressure that time from the defensive front. That time, Ethan Hurst, a 6 foot, 230-pound outside linebacker from Santa Margarita, Florida, got into the backfield in a hurry. He kind of got across Logan Kennedy's face there. Logan Kennedy came really close to getting a holding call.
Second down and 10 here for the Digs. Ball at their 41-yard line. One back, two receivers right, one of the lefts. Jet Campbell out of the shotgun again. Campbell stands in. Downfield, pass caught Hoffman. Boy, that thing was in the air a long time. That's first down yardage, and Jet Campbell gets up slowly as he took a shot. A pair of Rocky defenders coming at him hard. First and 10, Montana Tech.
Yeah, once again, Hurst was in there, but you have to credit Campbell. He could see both those guys coming, both of them, one from the right, one from the left. He stood in there and waited for Hoffman to hook up there beyond the first down markers, and that's a long throw. He's throwing from the far hash to a deep sideline here to the wide side, hit it right on the mark.
First down and 10, Montana Tech, one back. Man in motion, Wyatt Alexander again. Handoff going to go to Counts. Counts bounces left. Counts fights his way across the 45 to the 44. That's going to be a gain of 5 on first down.
Better looking run from Counts there. Made his decision a little quicker in the backfield and got upfield, you know, with a burst of speed. Was able to pick up 4 or 5 yards on first down. That's key. For as good as Rocky's defense is playing so far, this you know, those 4 or 5 yard chunks are key.
6 carries, 37 yards for Blake Counts as of right now. Second down and 6. Counts stays in the backfield. Jet Campbell out of the shotgun. 2 receivers left, 2 to the right. Hoffman all the way at the bottom. And play action. Campbell swings it out, left side, pass complete. It looked like Torgerson, I assume, out to the 33 near the 34-yard line.
Yeah, Torgerson made a great, you know, he reached back to get that. You know, he ran a little choice route, stop route. Campbell put it a little bit behind him. That's a tough catch. We talked about that in the Carroll game, how tough it is to catch a ball behind you. Torgerson reached out with his mitts and got it stuck.
Nice throw that time by Campbell. Tried to get it out there as quick as he could. Kind of threw it like he was a catcher in baseball. Threw it from his ear hole rather than the big windup.
That's the one that what was our favorite? Cavender? What was the guy's name?
Cavender?
Cavender. Clay Cavender used to catch that ball all the time.
First and 10. Handoff is going to go to Counts. Counts turns it upfield. Gets through the first level into the second. Across the 25. Muscles his way inside the 20 to the 19. That's a run of 14 for the big man.
Patient running, but when he's deciding to run now, he's hitting it just a half a second quicker. And you could see him once he got into space, he was just looking for somebody to hit.
Yep.
You gotta love him.
He came into camp cutting a significant amount of weight, but incredibly strong for Blake Counts.
You can see, you know, certain people have a weight to give, but Counts, he never really as big as he ever was. I mean, he carried about 3 or 4% body fat, you know, so for him to trim down, it had to be a tremendous amount of work.
Yeah, the guys, the coaches I talked to were just in awe of him coming into fall this year. Like, he was just ready. He got faster as well. First and 10, 3-step drop. Jet Campbell looking left the whole way, going to air it up into the end zone. That one's going to fall incomplete. Looked like Jordan Jackson was the intended target out toward the back pylon.
They tried to get a double move there, and Rocky didn't bite. And Jordan Jackson, in my opinion, I think if that ball comes closer to being caught, I think Jordan Jackson gets called for offensive pass interference. He gave his defender a little push in the back as that ball was in the air, but I think they probably ended up deeming it uncatchable.
So Jackson will check out. I'll get a little change at receiver here.
I think if I had played receiver, I'd just waste it down and tell the quarterback to throw it way over my head just so I could jack a defender. Wouldn't that be great?
Second and 10. Torgerson in motion. Stops in the slot. They're going to set up screen. And that one comes out busted from the get-go.
You know, and I talk about the lack of back screen in the college game anymore and how much I like it. Campbell's got to be more patient there. He's got to let almost another second for that thing to develop. He threw that ball a little quick at Counts. Counts didn't really have his head turned. He wasn't in position to catch the ball. You got to be real patient running back screen.
Third down and 10 here for the Digs. Ball at the 20-yard line. Montana Tech trailing 15-3 here in this first half. Really their first long sustained drive here in the first half.
Rocky, nobody in a three-point.
Three receivers out, crossing route. Torgerson gets it. He's inside the 15, still continuing to fight. And there's a late flag. I believe we're going to get a face mask as he was brought to the ground by the grill.
Boy, he's got great balance. He can take hits and stay on his feet that time. And I think the only thing that got him to the ground was a grab of the face mask.
Yeah. Yeah, he gets directed to the turf by the face mask. So
got to visit with his dad in the tailgate, you know, talking about the old days when I first started coaching. He was one of my receivers and such a good player. And Kyle, you know, he's got three sons here. He's got one playing basketball here. And, of course, Cody, the oldest one's on the Montana Tech staff. He had a bad ankle injury that never did get quite healed up. And then you got Kyle, and Kyle is a complete mimic of the old man.
So that is first down after the penalty yards. First and goal from the 7. Montana Tech offense looking to get some points on the board here. 6:25 left to play in the first half. Diggs trailing 15-3. Boy, we've seen some weird stuff so far here in the first half, and he's going to take it under center. Jet Campbell, heavy formation to his right. The deep back is Blake Counts. Long snap count, and now we'll get it whistled dead, and Rocky going to call a timeout.
I tell you what, I want to officiate football for one reason. You see the Rocky defensive end that time come in. I'll call him out. Bridger Danielson comes in. The whistle had been blown for 2 seconds, and he comes in. The whistle stopped. Jet Campbell stopped. He gets to Jet Campbell, and instead of just stopping, gives him one quick little shove. Why do you do that? I would throw a flag on that all day long.
I chose that is what is called
unnecessary offense.
And, well, I mean, it's that right intimidation, too, where you're going, hey, guess what? I'm here.
It is BS in the game.
Who knows what was said or done there? The right thing to do is the best friend.
Who knows? But
mechanical is filled with great job opportunities and has so much potential growth.
Our students walk out with really high paying jobs.
15-3, our score. Again, thanks for joining us on a Saturday afternoon.
I really need it.
Okay, I'm done. Are you sure? All right. So other games, Western leading Northern now 21-0. That was scoreless after one. They're in the second quarter, Western leading 21-0. College of Idaho and Southern will play later. Carroll College is at Eastern, I believe, as well.
Yeah, Coach Norris maybe delivered a little message on the sideline.
First and goal, Montana Tech. Campbell has Blake Counts, one step back, one step to his right. Two receivers on each side of the formation. Man in motion is our tight end. He'll stop on the right side. Handoff going to go to Counts. He has a lane. Counts across the 5, fighting inside. He'll push the pile down near the 1.
You know, there's a method to his madness. A lot of times it doesn't look like he hits the hole as quick as you want him to, but there's a method to his madness because once the contact's made, you always see him down 3 or 4 yards beyond that. You know, I don't know if he's sizing up angles or what he's doing, but a really nice run there after contact out of Blake Counts.
Counts right now, 7 carries, 50 yards. Again, he is the conference leading rusher at 87.5 a game. Jed Campbell under center, tight end in motion. They're trying to push him in, and he's not going to make it. Nice push that time by the Rocky defensive front. They're going to keep him out of the end zone. Yeah, that wasn't even – that was known from the get-go, boy. They made a nice push, but I'll tell you, that Rocky defensive front has played a really good game today.
Yeah, they have. They got a lot of knuckles in the dirt down there at the goal line. And Montana Tech is developing an offensive front. You know, they lost a couple from last year, you know, primarily Hunter Sparks. I ran into Hunter in the tailgate. And, you know, it's always good to see. But they're growing up quick, and they'll get the touchdown here.
Same play, pushing forward. This time they get through. Montana Tech will score. Jet Campbell with the quarterback keeper. And the Digs get on the board. Rocky leading 15-9. And the Digs will look to add to that. So a nice drive here, the longest drive of the day for Montana Tech.
I admire their patience. You know, they went back to Blake Counts. He's had success. Again, what'd you say, 7 carries for 50 yards? You know, some of them have been tough, but got to stick with the tough stuff because eventually it'll break, and we saw that a couple times. And stick to the game plan. A lot of football. You got down early, a lot of football left, and Montana Tech stayed patient and with their plan.
9 plays, 57 yards, 6 points. They'll look to add one more to that here. The kick is up, and it is through. 15-10 our score. The Battling Bears up over Montana Tech here at Alumni Coliseum. 5 minutes remaining here in the first half. We'll take a break. We're back after this.
Media. Time out.
Hey, welcome back here once again to the campus of Montana Tech Alumni Coliseum as the Digs will kick off. The Digs go 11 plays, 59 yards. They get 7 points out of it. Rocky leading 15-10. We'll get the football back with plenty of time here in this second quarter. Rocky with 2 timeouts remaining. And the kicking unit in here for the Digs. So once again, as we take a peek here, team-wise for both sides, Montana Tech now 8 first downs. They have 28 offensive plays, 139 yards. Rocky has 30 offensive plays for a 167. And this one goes out the back of the end zone again. Tremendous effort off the tee, and the Battling Bears will get the touchback and get us underway here. Again, plenty of time remaining here in this second quarter.
Yeah, lots of time. Just need a stop. You know, you can give up a first down. I see a flag in the middle of the football field around the 20-yard line. We'll see what this is.
The officials will chat it over here for a minute. Frontier Conference action here as a 5-point lead for the Bears. Montana Tech feels like they're getting their comfort level in here a little bit.
Personal foul.
And it's going to be a face mask call against Rocky.
Well, that hurts.
That'll back him up a little bit. So it goes back to the 12 and a half, and they'll start from there. Yeah, so the Bears.
Montana Tech defensively has seen, you know, a lot of what Rocky wants to do today. I think they're settling in pretty well. They know Dick is healthy enough to escape a little bit and try and run the football, so they're aware of that. You know, he is in the game. He's throwing really accurate balls, especially on the stop stuff. And Tech's reacted pretty well, giving up 15 points so far today.
Split backs, 3 receivers, handoff going to go to the tailback, and he goes nowhere. With the carry that time is going to be Matt White, the freshman out of California.
Yeah, good job. Trumbull was in there, went low, made a pile, and also Ben Windauer got up there out of his inside linebacker position and got into the feet of the back.
Second down and 10 here for the Bears. 4:44 left to play here in this first half. Montana Tech up defensively, nobody in a 3-point yet. Now we'll get one down. 4 receiver spread here for Rocky. Nathan Dick out of the shotgun. Nathan Dick, 3-step drop, stands, delivers right side through the hands of his intended target. That will fall incomplete. Donovan Selgren, the intended target.
Well, Montana Tech brought a little pressure package. They only had one guy in a 3-point stance, 3-man front, and they brought Sanchez up from the nickel back on a, you know, a nickel blitz, and one of the inside backers, that's the first time we've seen Dick on a stop route look really hurried and rush a throw. He had to rush it a little bit, and the ball sailed on him a little.
Third down and 10 here for the Bears. One back, four receivers once again. The Digs would love a three and out here and get the football back.
Look at all the defensive backs.
Dropping back, Nathan Dick in the pocket. He is now going to run. He's out across the 15, cut down at the 18. He'll pick up 7 yards on the ground, but that's going to bring up fourth down here for the Battling Bears.
What a great play. So many defensive backs. There had to be six or seven in there in the secondary for Montana Tech. And the guy who makes the play is on a three-man rush is Trumbull. He's upfield, but he chased Dick down. You know, he was on the chase with Dick. As soon as he changed direction, Trumbull was able to make the stop.
So fourth down, and the Bears will be forced to punt it away. So a big three and out for the Digger D. They'll actually put two return men back. And with plenty of time left, Montana Tech will look to try and chip away at this lead. Slot in motion. Not a shield unit. And now a pause. Now the kick is away. And a booming loose spiral bounces at the 26. Fielded at the 20. Trying to get the return set. And nice open field tackle. Boy, it looked like they were going to be able to bring it back this way. And making that tackle, I believe, was Waddle, Jack Waddle. Great special teams play. So Bullitt gets down and makes the play.
One of the plays of the game so far that, you know, it was one of the rolling punts, and the punter took his sweet time and got a great punt. Montana Tech was actually pretty fortunate, McNeil was, because that ball bounced, and the way it was flying, it looked like one that was going to lurch forward, but the ball did bounce up, so McNeil could at least field it. But Tech's pretty fortunate not to be inside their own 10-yard line right now.
They do have all three of their timeouts, 3:33 remaining here in the first half. The Digs up to the line of scrimmage. First down and 10, ball just across the 20, and Jet Campbell will get us rolling here. So Campbell brings the offense out. Campbell is 7-14 for 60 yards thus far. One back, three receivers looking to throw. He's going to air it up as Torgerson, the target. Ball comes out. Rocky gets it. No, still loose. Now Tech gets on it. What a break as Winterburn falls on the gift. Rocky had about four guys with hands on that football, and luckily jumping right on top of it is Caleb Winterburn.
That ball was on the ground for a long time. Rocky, two Rocky's defenders fight over the thing, and it squirts loose into Winterburn's hand. And Torgerson, it looked like he hurt his left elbow on that play.
I say it looked like he maybe got a helmet on the tackle, you know, as he was catching that football, and that's what caused that football to jump out, and he may have gotten injured on that, and actually a player down for Rocky as well. 3:10 left to play here in the first half. And the coaches will, players are all coming out here. Coach Sampson went out to see him.
See what Montana Tech brings out there. McNeil, who's got a lot of special teams experience, is listed as Torgerson's backup on that offense. So it looks like Torgerson's going to walk off the field here, probably over to the training table to get a look at that left elbow.
3:10 left to play here in the first half. Second down and 6 here for the Digs. And the officials telling them to get it moving here. As the trainers walk to the sidelines, Torgerson right behind him. Not moving that right arm a whole lot. Kind of, he is flexing that right elbow, as you mentioned. Second down and 6. Tech's offense comes out to the line of scrimmage. Torgerson stays on the sideline. He's not making his way over to the training bench yet. He's another one. We talked about Nathan Dick in the pregame being tough. I think getting Torgerson to the training bench would be just about impossible. Tight end in motion. Play action. They're going to swing it out on the left side. Pass complete. Hoffman has running room. Hoffman across the 40.
Lost the ball. He had the ball tucked under his left elbow and then started running.
Shot out of bounds.
Shot out of bounds at about the 40-yard line.
Hello. Ball a little slippery here for Montana Tech today. Hey, you see him down the sideline?
It happens. It happens. I distinctly remember that happening to me clear back in high school a couple times. You just be running with the football, and all of a sudden the thing squirts out.
First and 10, Montana Tech. One back, two receivers right, one of the lefts. Jed Campbell out of the shotgun. Rocky showing pressure from the top.
McNeil did a nice job. So, you know, I mentioned he's Torgerson's backup. He's in the game. He did a nice job on the quick out to Hoffman. He's the lead blocker there. He got hat on hat and maintained a block for Hoffman to turn the corner.
Four-man pressure. Handoff going to go to Winterburn. Winterburn turns it upfield, gets hit hard. He'll gain two, if that. Nice run, though, by the tailback, and Caleb Winterburn gets low, but he gets chopped down.
Montana Tech offensively won't really show any kind of a rush until they're probably under 2 minutes, maybe even close to a minute and a half. All three timeouts left, so
no real hurry here for Montana Tech offensively. The time might dictate the play calling a little bit, but no real hurry.
Second down and 9 here for the Digs. As we mentioned, they do have all 3 of their timeouts. Jed Campbell, 1 receiver wide left, 2 to the right. Hoffman on the bottom of your side for Montana Tech. Campbell dropping back, looking left the whole way. Pass across the middle, has a man off the fingertips, unable to hold on to it, as at tight end, trying to reel that one in was Logan Kennedy, unable to do so.
You've got to work the seam to Hoffman's side here. I just noticed something, you know, Rocky, when they show their umbrella coverage, the near side safety eyes are on Hoffman at the wideout spot and Hoffman alone. They're bracketing Hoffman, so the middle of the field against a 2-deep safety can be vulnerable. It's really vulnerable against Rocky's offense. You just need a one-on-one break on that inside slot, whether it's Torgerson, McNeil, in that case, Logan Kennedy coming from tight end.
Third down and 9 here for the Digs. Ball on their 36. Dropping back, crossing route. Pass is caught. First down yardage at the 47-yard line.
Alexander.
There you go. So Wyatt Alexander hauls in that catch. That will move the chains here for the Digs. Clock should stop. It's still running.
They should have started it, but it should have stopped at some point.
Yeah, it should have stopped to move the chains. The white hat looks like he is going to add some time here.
Please put 142 on the clock.
So our officiating crew will add a little time, and we'll go from there. Montana Tech right now, 5 plays, 31 yards thus far. They have 10 first downs on the day.
So you watch, I don't know if this is the same coverage, but you watch this near side safety on the hash mark at the 40-yard line. As they get closer to the snap of the football, watch where his eyes go. Hoffman's down here to the wide side, or to our side at wide out. They're clearly paying special attention to Hoffman.
Both teams
got him one-on-one here, though.
Both teams have now run 33 offensive plays. Montana Tech has gone for 170 yards. Jed Campbell out of the shotgun, 4-man pressure. Play action, he'll swing it left, pass complete. That should be very near first down yardage. Boy, not a great spot on the far side of the field. That's going to bring up second down here for the Digs. Ball at the Rocky 42, 80 seconds remaining here in the first half.
Rocky's mixing up their coverage. That time they clouded the corner to the far side of the field and rolled their safeties to deep third, deep middle, and then this near side corner had this deep third out here, but they're doing a good job of mixing up coverage. But Montana Tech is exploiting it a little bit.
2 receivers, check that, 3 receivers here on the bottom. Pressure coming. Jed Campbell running. He's in trouble. He'll get rid of the football. Jed Campbell just lobs it to the sideline to get rid of it. Clock does stop. 54 seconds remaining here in this first half. Third down and 1 for the Digs. Ball at the Rocky 43-yard line.
All day long here. You're probably going to see this ball get handed to counts here. And Montana Tech may or may not burn a timeout. They got 3 to go, almost a minute left in the first half, so they've got all day. They're across midfield. They're not hurried right now.
Third down and 1 here for the Digs. 1 back, 2 receivers to the bottom, 1 up top. Actually, 2 up top as well. Tight end goes in motion, and Rocky going to call a timeout. That's their second timeout here in the first half.
Timeout.
We'll go ahead and keep it here as the coach comes out, talks to a corner right out of the gate. So the teams will chat it over here. So again, thanks for joining us. Bob Greenfield, Frontier Conference Football. Let's see if we can track down which window I have my other scores in here real quickly. So Western leading Northern 21-0. College of Idaho at Southern about midway through the first quarter. That one's scoreless. And Carroll at Eastern is also scoreless about midway through the first. So again, Western at Northern leading 21-0. That was scoreless after 1.
See how Eastern reacts to a tough early season here so far. Always have a tremendous amount of good athletes.
Yeah, and that I'll tell you, that College of Idaho Southern game's got some weight on it too. You know, if you're Southern, the idea of falling to 1-2 out of the gate is not what you want. And for College of Idaho, obviously, you've got to keep the gas pedal to the floor to try and move up that top 25 and stay up on top with the Frontier Conference.
I still kind of want to go to a game at College of Idaho. I still haven't seen their facility and
it's
all
nice.
That. I got a brother that lives down in the Boise area whose in-laws are College of Idaho alum, you know, back when it was Albertson. And they go to games quite a bit and says it's a great atmosphere.
Yeah, they do a good job. They pack the place. 2 receivers on each side of the formation. Jed Campbell brings man in motion. That's your tight end. He'll stop. Campbell, handoff to Counts. Counts fights his way forward. He gets first down yardage plus several. He's down to the 39-yard line. They'll stop the clock to move the chains. 48 seconds remaining here in the opening half. Rocky leading by five. Tech has all three timeouts. Rocky still with one.
Let's see if they can catch Rocky. And, you know, one of their various coverages they're giving them. See if they can, you know, they've been pressing the corner a little bit to Hoffman's side. So Hoffman must be, oh, he's on the inside slot here. They're going to work Hoffman through the middle of the field here.
Blitz coming from the defensive back. Jet Campbell steps up in trouble. He gets hit, and he'll be taken down by the corner that was blitzing. That's going to be a loss of four, bring up second and 14. So the blitz came from the bottom side as Brusfin will get the sack.
That's their first
and
time
that will be a timeout called here for the Digs. We'll keep it here. 26 seconds remaining in the first half. As Rocky leading by five.
You got to use the whole football field now if you're Montana Tech, second and long. You got to keep it between the hash marks. You got two timeouts. You might as well use them. It's tough to use more than two in a 26-second window at this level. And so keep the whole playbook in mind. You know, Campbell's gotten a little bit of pressure early with not huge pressure packages here in the first half. So Montana Tech's got to maybe start running some route combinations that aren't involving a 10 or a 15-yard vertical run downfield first. You know, a little more maybe crossing to the field and let guys recognize zone or man coverage and either keep running or settle down in zones.
Second and 14 here for the Digs after the sack. They brought the safety up, and he was able to get some pressure and take him down. So the Digs with the ball at the 44-yard line of Rocky. Jet Campbell, let's get a rolling here. Up to the line of scrimmage they come. Out of the shotgun, Campbell. One back, two receivers on the bottom, one up top. Campbell, three-step drop, screen here on the near side to Hoffman. He gets it. Hoffman across the 35. He'll get hammered down to the 32. Very close to first down yardage. But Tech will call their second timeout.
Really good play call. They ran the receiver slip screen. They actually got away with, I think they had contact downfield. Hoffman was beyond the line of scrimmage there when he received that ball. You know, that usually you get any downfield blocking, that ball's got to be completed in the backfield. But I think Hoffman was a little bit downfield, but a really good play call. Rocky had four guys at the line of scrimmage, and they twisted and crossed their inside linebackers to get pressure on Campbell. So they timed it up well. That's good homework during the week.
18 seconds left to play here in the first half. Tech with one timeout remaining. Third down and two. And again, the Digs looking to add some points here before we go into the locker room. You going to be okay?
I got some songs in my head.
All right. Montana Tech, 38 offensive plays, 186 yards. Rocky, 33 offensive plays, 174. Remember, that was really one-sided through about the middle of the second quarter here. Rocky had run a truckload more plays than Tech, and Tech's offense really started to get a little confidence as the second quarter got rolling.
That's just a bunch of grown-ups on the sideline, right? You know, they realized it, you know, they had a couple things not go their way earlier in this football game. They didn't hit the panic button and went, you know, back to their weak preparation. What are we going to do? Showed some patience and have closed the gap in this game.
Third down and two. Tight end in motion. Handoff going to go to Blake Counts. Counts fights his way toward the line of scrimmage. He's going to be short. That's going to bring up fourth down and one. And they do call a timeout. 12 seconds remaining here in the first half, and Montana Tech will call their final timeout of the first half. So they kept it on the ground, and they are shut down from the first down marker. Rocky was all screaming. They were pointing that they got the football out of that. But I assume it was a matter of thinking it was fourth down rather than third.
So what are you going to do here? You saw what you didn't look over. I was kicking the field goal.
Okay.
Yeah, I say you kick the field goal here. You're going to be looking at a
50-yarder. Just under
48 yards, 49-yard field goal.
As I mentioned when I talked to Coach Sampson on Thursday, I came up and we chatted. He said 45 in they were on. So we'll see if that does extend out a little bit. I was kind of interested where we're at on the sidelines. Torgerson is not on the training table, and he's
been back in the game already.
Exactly.
Yeah, he's been back in the game already. He's he's ready to go. Yeah, I wonder if maybe he took one on the old funny bone.
Yeah, not so funny.
The not so funny bone.
So fourth down and short here for the Digs. Remember, no timeouts. 12 seconds remaining here in this first half, and Montana Tech will keep the offense on the field.
I don't think I'm going to be getting any calls from Kyle Sampson, head coach of Montana Tech, anytime soon. I am completely backwards of their thought process.
One back, tight formation, play action. Campbell rolling right. Campbell has time. Now he is going to run. Campbell across the 30, out of bounds at the 25 with 5 seconds remaining in the first half. So they get a fresh set of downs. You're going to get one shot at the end zone here with 5 seconds.
I don't know if you can get a shot to the end zone in 5 seconds. I don't know. They're running the field goal team on. It would be tough.
Okay, so they will try and go for three here. So the kicking unit comes in.
You would need Eddie Kelly on the clock here.
Oh, Eddie. Well, you know he didn't pay to get his way in here either.
Hey, a hometown clock keeper can make his check and extend his contract really quick.
Rocky will call their final timeout here of the half and try and ice the kicker a little bit. So it will be, they put it down at the, I think it'll be about a 42-yard attempt as we approach half. It's been kind of a long first half, honestly. We've had a lot of penalties. We've had some awkward moments.
I wasn't even thinking. I could have got us a great halftime guest today.
And we have one. And I'll
do
you that.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. I was going to check with you because, you know, I sing his praises all the time. One of my all-time favorites, probably top three since maybe 1985, Gunnar Kaiser's back in the area. And got to visit with him a little bit in the tailgate. And just one of my all-time favorite players. So close to or was a 4-0 in petroleum engineering, but now he's working over in Three Forks. Would have been a great guest, but
we have time. Think. We'll get him up here. We're going to talk with Jamie Hepler, the new executive director of the Montana Tech Foundation, coming off of day one this past week.
Well, he can't tell us about knocking people into the dirt. Well, maybe he can.
So the kicking unit is in, field goal unit. A 42-yard attempt from the right hash mark. So the field goal unit is ready to roll here. Tech trailing by 5. Snap and hold are good. The kick is up, has plenty of leg, and it splits them. That would have been good from another 10 easy, don't you think?
Yes.
So the field goal is good. Rocky leading 15-13. Zeros on the clock. And it looks like that is where we're going to end it. So we have two quarters in the books. And the Battling Bears leading Montana Tech 15-13. Frontier Conference action here from Bob Greenfield. We'll take a timeout. We are back here to alumni right after this. Hey, welcome back here once again to Bob Greenfield, Alumni Coliseum, as the Battling Bears up over Montana Tech 15-13 here at the half. Thanks for joining us here with Montana Tech and joined at the half here by Jamie Hepler, the new executive director of the Montana Tech Foundation. Jamie, how you doing?
I'm doing great.
That's
so
awesome.
Thanks so much for having me.
Well, welcome to Tech.
Yeah, well, it's been quite the day so far. I mean, we're down 2, but I feel like we completely dominated the second half.
Okay.
So I'm pretty excited about what we're going to be able to do to Rocky in the next couple of quarters. But yeah, the 3 weeks that we've been here in Butte has been absolutely tremendous. And so looking forward to going to 3-0 here.
I can't imagine that it has You know, I don't think there's ever a time where it's a good time to come into a new position, but you come in right as day one is at its absolute peak, and has to be one of the busiest windows for the Montana Tech Foundation. So the idea of kind of trying to find any kind of balance through that time has to be awful hard.
It is, but I actually have found it to be incredibly rewarding. You know, I get to come in at a time where everybody is excited to start school. We have our biggest fundraiser of the year in day one. The team at the Montana Tech Foundation has done a tremendous job at building a true legacy, as the day one fundraiser has now grown just over the last 6 years. You know, this year raising, you know, over $325,000 with over 600 gifts. Yeah. You know, that's a tremendous testament to the Montana Tech Foundation team. There's a lot of work that goes into that on the back end as well. And so big shout out to the team that really pulled that off last week. We're really excited about the effort.
Were you surprised how addicting it is to sit and log on and just watch that thing continue to roll? It's horrible, isn't it? It's so addicting. It's insane.
Well, yeah. Well, you know how sometimes your phone comes up and it tells you how much screen time you've done over the course of the week? Mine doubled over 2 days. So, I was pretty addicted just to watch. Again, just coming into this kind of with fresh eyes and knowing that there have been some great leaders at the Montana Tech Foundation before me, you know, and just thinking, gosh, you know, we'll see how this goes, and just being completely blown away by the pride that Montana Tech, our alumni, family, and friends has. I just think, you know, it's a great, great day to be an org digger. Obviously, every day is, but I think the momentum that I feel like I get the opportunity to jump right into, it's a true blessing, and my family and I are just really, really excited to kind of get started here and keep this tremendous legacy going.
Let's talk about you a little bit and what brings you to Tech. And obviously you have family ties in Butte, Montana. So kind of talk a little bit about yourself and what brings you to the position.
Yeah, I think, you know, it was kind of funny that the position kind of came into an inbox of mine in my former role at Washington State University. And I just thought, you know, this just seems like something I should look into. My family is originally on the mom's side, originally from Butte, Montana. My grandfather is a Butte legend, Sam Jankovic. He won 2 Butte High state championships, so I'm pretty proud of that.
As you should be.
And then went on to a tremendous career at Washington State, University of Miami, and the New England Patriots. So I do feel a sense of, you know, belonging here in Butte. A lot of my time as a child was up here. My cousin Ted Ackerman, Butte High guy, also Montana Tech star basketball player in his day, taught me how to play the game. So just being able to come home to Butte and be a part of Montana Tech just seems like the right thing.
It kind of a kismet moment, honestly, when you see that inbox?
Completely. And, you know, I think one of the things that has been so great thus far is just the people have really embraced myself, my family. You know, my husband, Tommy Hepler, is working with Matt Steppen in the athletic department under the foundation umbrella, and I think he's going to obviously do another tremendous work with Matt and his team to bring athletics and the foundation into a new kind of era. So excited to kind of watch that play out. But also my 2 kids, James and Eloise. One goes by JT Money. The other goes by Lulu. They're 6 and 8. They're fabulous children. Obviously, they're mine. But, you know, getting them started in school, you know, it's just been great. People have been just so wonderful and so nice and so welcoming. And sometimes, you know, when you come back to a place like that where, you know, we just haven't had family in some of our other areas. So we feel very fortunate to be in Butte today.
And taking a position, you always have expectations. You always have things that you expect to come across or things that, you know, maybe you come in with expectations. How have the first 3 weeks gone? I mean, have you had expectations? What are things that have surprised you? What are the things that have kind of changed your perspective or anything along those lines?
I mean, the expectations, you know, obviously when I have an expectation, usually I'm the one that gets, you know, burned by the expectation. But I gotta tell you, like, the Montana Tech Foundation team is one in which is incredibly dynamic. Each individual has their own personality. personal passion, their own ability that's really going to bring us into this kind of next year. You know, last year we had our largest fundraising year of our in our history. This year we've already gotten off to a tremendous start. Again, we just recently announced the Art Ditto $1 million professorship last week. We're coming up on another big announcement, hopefully in the next couple of weeks. So expectations-wise, honestly, they've completely blown me away. But what I'm most proud of is the team that I get to work with.
Yeah. I would assume the other part, that the one of the fun ones that I've come across with Shannon is, you know, people that are returning to campus for the first time in a long time. You know, you come up Park Street and nothing has changed. You know, you look up, you see the statue, you see, you know, the buildings you're familiar with. And once you clear the statue and drop down into the hill, that's when people are taken aback. You look at the construction, you look at all the new things on campus. Did you have one of those moments when your first time back?
Absolutely. You know, we drove up over the hill and into the just down the hill and seeing all these incredible new facilities for our students and our student athletes. You know, it's something that, you know, when I left as an 18-year-old kid, you know, coming back and forth from Spokane to Butte, this was not here.
Yeah.
But I will tell you that Montana Tech is an elite institution in the state of Montana. You know, our programs here are really going to propel the future workforce. And I think that's something that, you know, the foundation as, you know, a conduit to tell that story. You know, I'm pretty excited to, you know, be a part of such an incredible institution that has such rich history, but is also kind of looking at how it's going to expand and grow. I mean, look at the nursing department. I mean, I went into that nursing facility the other day, the Sherry and Dave Lazar Nursing Center, and, you know, the school, the simulation space. I mean, that's just like bar none. You do not see that anywhere else.
And that sim stuff is amazing. The sim center is just so state of the art and so incredible. The idea of that being a learning center and always evolving, you know, and to think that it's, I mean, it's really still in its infancy. You know, it's not like nursing has been established here for 50 years. We're under, you know, we're still not even double digit years, for goodness sake, in nursing. And you look at the great work that has been done in that space, and the future there seems incredibly bright, much like everything else.
Absolutely. And that's the work of the foundation, right? That's, you know, Dave and Sherry Lazar are our largest individual donors in our history, and they truly make an impact for future students in the healthcare region. You know, just coming off of COVID, you know, there are going to be a tremendous need for good healthcare workers. And, you know, we couldn't thank Dave and Sherry enough for their contribution and their continued contribution to thousands of students that are going to have to go through Montana Tech in a space that, honestly, you're not going to get anywhere else.
Well, Jamie, again, welcome. We love having you here, and certainly can't wait to revisit in a year and see what has changed in perspective, because 3 weeks has certainly been great, and can't wait to see how everything sets in the coming years moving forward.
Well, thank you so much for this time. And again, Montana Tech Foundation is here, and it's in support of the initiatives of the Montana Tech Strategic Plan. So if you do have an interest in giving, please visit our website, montanatechfoundation.com.
No joke, especially if you saw the need that was out there for day one. You know, if you went into any of the initiatives or any of the different departments and the things that they were looking for help in, it gave you a great idea of, you know, ways you can help not only during day one, but also in the years to come for all those great departments.
Absolutely. It's one of our greatest traditions, and we're going to keep it rolling. So, roll digs.
There you go. Jamie Hepler, ladies and gentlemen, CEO of the Montana Tech Foundation. We're at the half. We'll take a break. We'll come back. We'll give you the numbers and more right after this. welcome back here once again as we are on the campus of Montana Tech at Alumni Coliseum here at Bob Greenfield. The Battling Bears leading Montana Tech 15-13 here on this Saturday afternoon. Montana Tech nationally ranked number 21 as of this week. Rocky Mountain College, coming off the College of Idaho loss, has dropped out of the top 25 but are receiving votes in the national poll at last take. So let's talk some numbers here, shall we? We'll start team number-wise. As we mentioned, Rocky really dominated the numbers in control of the football in that first quarter leading into the second quarter, and then that started to change. Montana Tech in the second quarter really got the offense going. They started to run the football. They were able to throw the football down the field, and their offense got comfortable is really kind of what it felt like. And especially, you know, it was something that we haven't seen out of this Montana Tech offense this year. You know, you think about the Eastern game, the offense got rolling hard in that one, and same in Carroll, especially in the first half against Carroll. You know, Montana Tech's offense really didn't have much in the way of issues, you know, moving through. So Montana Tech's offense kind of got stumbling there out of the gates, but once they got their balance under them, everything seemed to work all right. Rocky with 11 first downs in that first half. Let me take a look here at our overall numbers. They ran 33 plays, did the Battling Bears, for 174 yards. They ran the ball 15 times for 78 yards in the first half, 11 catches for 96 through the air. Dick, well, I guess we'll talk about individual numbers here in just a minute. Team numbers continuing for Rocky Mountain College. They had 5 penalties for 30 yards. They punted the ball twice, 55.5 yard average. That's a good day at the office. Rocky was 2 of 6 on third downs, 1 of 1 on fourth down. So again, the Battling Bears, 33 offensive plays, 174 yards, 11 first downs, and the good chunk of those were in that first quarter. On the other side for Montana Tech, they had the ball for 40 plays, 188 total yards of offense. They had 12 first downs. They ran the ball 19 times for 82 yards as a team, completed 12 passes for 106 yards. Otherwise, the Digs today have fumbled the ball twice. They lost it once. And from there, they've been penalized twice for 20 yards and have they're 5 of 11 on third downs in the first half, for goodness sake, and 1 of 3 on fourth down in this ball game. Anything else jumping off the page at you there, Haskell?
No, the stats really do kind of reflect the score of the game. Rocky up 15-13. Passing yards are somewhat close, 96 and 106. Rushing yards are somewhat close. Yeah, it's a hard-fought football game. Rocky's playing a really good game. Tech settled in, especially defensively, and you know, they've been kind of tough for Rocky to overcome. But we've seen Rocky show patience and move the football and get in the end zone a couple times. Dick's playing a really good game.
Yeah,
you know, they're rumored coming in, you know, how bad Dick's injury was, doesn't appear to be really slowing him down. He's shown the ability to, showed the ability and the willingness to run the football when he's needed to, but he's been really good on the stop stuff, you know, the hook to curl, the to out game. He's had some overthrows on the deep balls here, but he's still threatening and throwing it, you know, and that's key. You know, you have to remind a defense that you're going to throw the ball over the top once in a while just to keep them at home. And I think Montana Tech does a pretty good job of that. And Rocky's done a pretty good job of that so far as well. So, yeah, Montana Tech's got to shore up some stuff in the locker room, in their pass protection. Rocky's kept Campbell pretty uncomfortable back there. And, you know, so they're probably going to look at a few things. You know, if they want to get the Hoffmans of the world downfield a little bit, you know, they might have to maybe dial up some back help. Not just blitz check type stuff, but back help with, you know, chipping on some of that edge pressure that they've seen. Maybe keeping a tight end in for some protection occasionally. You know, we struggled with pass protection. We just keep a tight end. We used to call it a Wyoming call, and just to give that quarterback a little more of a security blanket, another half second. Sometimes a half second or a quarter second's all you need to really start to get some guys and stretch a secondary out. So we'll see how that develops here in the second half.
Individual numbers. We'll start it off for Rocky Mountain College offensively. Nathan Dick is 11 of 18 through the air. He's thrown for 96 yards right now, one touchdown. He has not been sacked today, and really hasn't even really been threatened when it boils right down to it. He gets rid of the football so quickly, makes great decisions. Nathan Dick has thrown for 96 yards. He has run the ball for 27 yards, four carries for 27 yards. Wilcox has nine carries for 48 for Rocky Mountain College. And then receiving-wise, Henry with three catches for 33. Wilcox has three catches for 22 out of the backfield. He also has the lone score on the offensive side there. Simon, two catches for 15 for the Battling Bears. Now, Montana Tech, Jet Campbell is 12 of 21 through the air. He has thrown for 106 yards. No touchdowns as of yet. He has been sacked once here today. So Jet Campbell completing 57% of his passes so far. Rushing the ball, Blake Counts, 10 carries, 59 yards, averaging, like I say, nearly 6 yards a carry here as of right now. He had a 31-yarder in the first half. Campbell has run the ball five times for 21 yards. Torgerson, one for four. Winterburn, three carries for 3 yards. Receiving, Hoffman, five catches for 48 yards. Torgerson, five for 41. Alexander Peterson also with one catch apiece in this football game. So we had a couple turnovers early, some momentum swings early. We'll see what the second half is going to present.
Yeah, a couple big plays early, but then it just really turned into a typical Frontier Conference grind. You know, two kind of like opponents. You're going to see some three and outs. You know, so special teams becomes a big part of the game. You know, executing the punting game, that kind of stuff, flipping the field position. And, yeah, you know, two teams that are playing pretty good football here today. And penalties haven't been that crazy. Rocky's got five penalties, Tech with a couple. You know, just those kind of things, you know, that when everything else kind of slows down and is hard to do, you really start to pay attention to the special teams game and penalties, and we'll see how that develops here into the second half.
Well, as you look at those first 30 minutes, Haskey, walk us through, what are they talking about in the locker room? From Montana Tech, Coach Kyle Sampson, what did they address, do you think, after that first 30 minutes?
Well, I think a couple things. You know, I'm sure they adjusted on the fly on the sideline to what Nate Dick's doing well on the field, you know, the stop route type stuff. They're doing a good job of staying on top of anything deep. And, you know, maybe trying to, you know, the couple times they did get in, they haven't sacked Dick, but the couple times they did get in his face, it created some wild throws, you know. So maybe they're talking defensively about maybe getting a little quicker pressure at certain times against Nate Dick. But, you know, they were a couple missed tackles away in that first half from getting one or two more three and outs.
Yeah.
You know, those kind of things. So, you know, they're talking about the basics defensively. Offensively, I think they're working and talking. And it seems like this used to be the case a lot of times when I coach. You'd go in and fix some pass protection issues, you know, and keep your quarterback comfortable. And you've heard me say it now probably too many times, but when Campbell's comfortable back there, he is as accurate as anybody I've ever seen up here. You know, if you get him uncomfortable, he'll start to run around maybe a little wildly. We saw him, you know, fairly successfully get away a couple times in the first half, but that isn't always the case. You know, always go back to quarterbacks don't outrun DNs anymore. They just don't, you know. So the escapes and the, you know, being comfortable is a good pass drop, a step up in the pocket. Keep your eyes downfield. You know, I was listening to Peyton on the Monday night game, and Peyton said it best. Don't look at the pressure, feel the pressure. Keep your eyes downfield. You know, keep moving forward and keep your eyes downfield. And it's great advice to give a quarterback. And until you sit back there, it's really difficult to do. It's an uncomfortable, if you're claustrophobic, you can't do it.
But almost feels like instinct more than like knowledge. It feels like something you're born with, not something, it doesn't feel like something you can develop from my perspective.
And in Campbell's defense, a couple times we saw loose pass rushers get loose, and we watched him sit in there and wait until he was ready to deliver the ball, knowing he was going to take a shot, and he waited and delivered the football. So that, you know, that growing is still coming with him, but they're working on pass protection, and then maybe some route combinations that are maybe a little quicker to open up, you know, a little more, you know, drags cross. Showing them a bunch of different coverages. You know, they've gone three deep. They've gone quarters. They've gone half field stuff, you know, with press corners, you know, all that stuff. They've given him a lot of different looks. And to Campbell's credit, he hasn't looked confused. I wouldn't say he's looked confused. You know, I agree. I think they've always gone the right place in the – in the or with the football. But in true passing downs, you'll watch, you know, you heard me mention that in the first half, that near side safety's eyes were locked on Hoffman with under over coverage. And I tell you what, I see that. So if I'm sitting in the booth, this is the kind of communication that I used to make to say the Ron Richards and Doug Schliemanns of the world. Let's get a guy down the middle of the field next time in that situation. Let's trust our guy because we're going to get him one-on-one with either a nickelback or an inside linebacker. And you got to like your guy there, you know, because that safety, even though it looks like he's here, he's leaving at the snap of the football. He's not going to be an issue. And you know, when you're looking for a big hitter, you know, a big strike. So we'll see if they went in and talked about that kind of stuff at halftime.
Real quickly, other scores. Western leading Northern 21-0 in the third. College of Idaho is trailing Southern 14-7. And Eastern Oregon leading Carroll 14-7. Both of the Oregon games are late. They're an hour behind us, so they're only in the second quarter. So the first kickoff will go out of bounds. Montana Tech will take over at their 35-yard line. That one flirted with the pylon there. So the Digs offense will look to see if they can keep things rolling here in this third quarter.
Good field position, and you know, the good thing about halftime is you come out and you get to see right away what they talked about. Yeah. I mean, you know, especially offensively, you'll see right away because, you know, fortunately for Montana Tech, even though sometimes the yards have been tough, I keep wanting to call him Jet Counts. Blake Counts is getting close to 6 yards a carry here in this game, so you've got to believe that that can continue. So you stick to your running game because so much of your pass success in play action is going to come off Counts being in the backfield. And just as I say that, you look out and Caleb Winterburn's in the game at tailback.
Winterburn is in at tailback. So two receivers, right, tight end, right, out of the shotgun. Jet Campbell here on first and 10 from the 35. Man in motion will get the fly motion. And trying to turn it upfield is Torgerson. Torgerson can't get past the first man. Nice job defensively tracking him down is going to be Blake Allred out of, or not
that's
Allred.
Brezvin.
Wrong side. That's Brezvin again.
That's Brezvin. You know, and Brezvin is, you know, I mentioned he's from Shelby Coyote. That's kudos to him for that. But he was a really good wrestler in high school. And you just don't see wrestlers. He runs real well. Of course, he's a tremendous athlete. Runs real well, but he doesn't miss when he gets his hands on you. And that's a trait of all good wrestlers.
Second down and 9 here for the Digs. And the linesman on the far side of the field going to come talk to the white hat here for a moment. Oh, the clock did not start. So we're still at 15 minutes on the clock.
That could be key.
That could create an issue. Will we see if Eddie Kelly is in charge of the clock again?
I informed him during our break at halftime that we were able to call him out a little bit.
Oh, I love it. Second down and 9 here for the Digs. Trying to get, I assume, the clock situated here.
So what you do here is you run the replay, and you go 1,000, 2, 1,000, 3.
Thanks. Why don't you just go down there and take care of it, Haskett? You've got all the answers today. It's good to go, man.
The answers. They're wrong answers, but they're answers nonetheless.
All right, so we go to 14:48. Do we get a whistle on a start here, or we're still waiting?
I've seen them put Hoffman inside here a little bit earlier this season, but they've moved him inside for quite a few snaps here. And when I say inside the from Z to X or H, let him work on these safeties a little bit.
You see him in the slot at the top of your screen. Man in motion is tight end again. Out of the shotgun snap. Almost goes by Campbell. Loose on the ground, and I think Rocky's got it. I believe Brusman got on that football, and that's the case. Rocky Mountain College is going to get that football. So the turnover, the snap went by Jet Campbell's side. They were able to knock it down, and Brusman comes flying through and gets on that football.
Well, the decision there, it looked like it took Campbell a while to react to that football, but he was kind of waiting for it to maybe take a little bit of a cherry hop so he could pick it up and continue the play. But Brusman came untouched and had a nose for that football. He dove in there and got his hands on it and wrestled it away from both, looked like Counts and Campbell there in the backfield.
So Montana Tech came in with no turnovers on the year thus far. They have 2 today. Rocky with a short field will try and make him pay for it. They lead by 2, 15-13. Nathan Dick out of the shotgun. Play action. Dick wants to throw. He's going to drop it off to his tight end. Pass complete to Simon. Chopped down at the 21. It's going to be a gain of 5.
Good hit by Jake Orvis that time out there in the secondary. He was pressed that time and let the vertical release go. He passed him on to a safety. Reacted to that out route to the big tight end Simon. Came up and just chopped Simon down to the ground.
Second down and 6 officially. One back. And out of the shotgun again, Nathan Dick. Nathan Dick will hand it off to his tailback. He'll fight across the 20 down to the 19-yard line. That's a gain of two. Bring up third down and three here for the Bears.
You know, Zach Trumbull's one of the best tacklers at the defensive front that I've seen in a long time. He just, you know, you'll see a guy try and run through his arms, big and strong, but he just doesn't allow anything. Once he gets his hand on a back, he just doesn't allow any more further progress.
Third down and three here for the Bears. Montana Tech, nine guys in the box. Now they spread out the linebackers a little bit. Nathan Dick out of the shotgun, long snap count. Looking to his right, flush to his right. Nathan Dick trying to find somewhere to go. He's across the 20, out of bounds at the 16. And depending on the spot,
he's going to be about a yard short. I think they have him at the 17. So this is a big decision here in this half. You can get a more than a field goal lead. If you're rocking, it looks like, well, they're running a couple bodies, but it looks like offensive personnel out. So it looks like Rocky early in the second half is going to go for it. They need every bit of a yard, maybe a little more.
I'd say, yeah, it feels from up here, it looks like a little over a yard, maybe close to a yard and a half. Nathan Dick, one back, three receivers tight up top. Montana Tech presents a three-man front. Pressure coming. Nathan Dick going to run. He's across the 15, spins down to the 10-yard line. Nathan Dick, first down yardage here for the Battling Bears.
Yeah, Morley came up from safety, had to make the tackle. Real well executed up front that time, just inside zone with a lead blocker for Nathan Dick that time. And Dick ran with a purpose that time. Morley had to come up in space and make the one-on-one tackle.
First and goal from the nine. Bears up to the line of scrimmage, off of the turnover. They have 6 points off of a turnover from Montana Tech today. Four receivers, hand off to the tailback, stretching the field left, trying to get to the sidelines, across the five. Big hit delivered down to the 4-yard line.
It looked like Angel Sanchez coming up after, looked like maybe Morley got into the feet of the back, and Sanchez came up and polished off the running back. Is that Wilcox?
That is Wilcox. So Wilcox on the day, 10 carries, 50 yards for the Battling Bears. Second and goal from just inside the five. Wilcox at tailback. Three receivers right, nobody covering all the way out on the far right side. And handoff to Wilcox again. He gets hammered but leans forward down toward the two. Boy, it looked like Montana Tech defensively not quite sure what was happening there as they got to the line of scrimmage. I believe they only even had two guys covering the three receivers here on the near side.
Rocky's doing a pretty good job. Their wideouts and tight end, you know, when they're detached, are doing a nice job of making and maintaining contact on their blocks. Because I'm wondering why Rocky's running outside the tackles here.
You got three receivers out on the left side. Hand off to Wilcox. Wilcox straight ahead. No signal yet.
No, he didn't get in. He's just short. He's going to be inside the 1-yard line.
So fourth down here for the Battling Bears, fourth and less than one.
Let's see, Montana Tech's going to run another heavy into that defensive front. Now, they've pretty much in short yardage have just given a three-man surface, but I'd expect at least six at the line of scrimmage here.
So here they come up to the line of scrimmage. Nathan Dick out of the shotgun, fourth and less than one. Dick's going to keep it. He'll go off tackle right. He gets stood up, but he gets in. Nathan Dick is in for 6 points. So the Battling Bears have two touchdowns off of two Montana Tech turnovers today. And they go up 21-13 here over the Digs. Now remember, Montana Tech has blocked two PAT attempts, and now we're going to get a flag late to the party again.
And we'll see at Tech. I think it might get an unsportsmanlike here out of one of the Rocky Bigs here. So we'll see if Montana Tech chooses to take it on the PAT or on the field goal. It looks like there's going to be a 15-yard penalty here. I think I might take it on the PAT here, just knowing it's an 8-point difference, and points have been tough to come by.
Okay.
Because Montana Tech has blocked a PAT, correct?
Two.
Or two, yeah. So
after the play,
so the foul's going to go against Rocky Mountain College, and they will do exactly what you're saying. The PAT attempt will come outside the 15, out to the 18-yard line.
Because they had left their offense on the field to go for two to possibly make it a 10-point game, and now they just ran the PAT field goal team out, and Montana Tech, well, we'll see here.
Well, maybe now Montana the officials moving it back.
Make them make a decision.
Now the football going back to the original spot.
Now Montana Tech's going to take that penalty on the kickoff.
And that will change the unit out again.
I like this decision from Montana Tech. This defense has been pretty stingy in these situations. It's just outside like the design Nathan Dick run area. I think they force
Rocky Mountain College to throw the football here.
So they do. The offense does come out for the Battling Bears. Three receivers right, one to the left, one back and home here for Nathan Dick. Gets the snap, looking right. He's going to go to his back, who gets past one defender inside the five. He'll be shut down at the one. Two-point conversion, no good. Great pursuit by the Digger D. They'll shut it down, so 6 points for the Bears. Puts them up by eight. 21-13 our score. The Bears up over Montana Tech. Frontier Conference action here on Bob Green Field at Alumni Coliseum. Looks like we'll get a break on the field, so with it, we'll take one as well. We're back here to Bob Green right after this. Hey, welcome back once again as we are here on the campus of Montana Tech, Bob Greenfield, Paul Panisco, the lovely and talented Ron Haskett.
Thank you.
An 8-point lead here for the Battling Bears. The kick will go back to the 20-yard line.
The second time today, Rockies had to kick from their own 20 on unsportsmanlike penalties. First time Tech got it out over the 40-yard line to start their series, and we'll see if they can't start in a little better shape this time. Bresman does a nice job of putting air under the ball and getting a little distance and allowing his cover team to get down and make the tackle.
So the kick from the 20-yard line. Rocky with 12 of their 21 points coming off of turnovers today. End-over-end kick has good distance. Air under. Return starts at the 10. Out across the 25, going right is Torgerson. Torgerson with a blocker in a lane. He's across the 40, 45, and out of bounds. It looks like between the 45 and 50. The Rocky coaching staff, they pointed it out. Nice job by the coach over there. He's pointing at the white spot at the 43-yard line.
Good-looking return, nonetheless.
Yep, so same spot as last time out that the kick started at the 20, right at the 43-yard line.
You know, they ruined kickoff returns. They literally ruined them when they outlawed the wedge and the crossing wedge. They just ruined them. All you could hear every kickoff was crunch, crunch, crunch.
Do you just sit in your rocking chair and just yell at people to get off your lawn during the week?
Don't even start me.
First down.
Don't even start me.
Holy man.
I know. I'm a crotchety old man.
First and 10 for the Dicks. Jet Campbell out of the shotgun. One back is Blake Counts, man in motion. And Counts is going to get it. Counts straight ahead. And not much there. Maybe two forward progress. He ran into a wall of white. There was nothing but Rocky defensive lineman in his vision.
Yeah, Rocky's been there all day. You know, occasionally you'll see one pop. But for the most part, Rocky's done a nice job against the tackle-to-tackle running game out of Montana Tech. I got a great story. Our next break, we talk about kickoff return, about when Coach Green first got into town, and along with his defensive coordinator and special teams coordinator, Kevin Corliss.
Okay.
It's a great one.
Second down and 8, three receivers here for Campbell. Four men, now blitz coming. Campbell steps up in the pocket, delivers. Pass complete to his tight end across the 40, down to the 35-yard line. So Montana Tech in stride hits Logan Kennedy, and Kennedy going to move the chains at the 35.
Right on cue. You get Logan Kennedy on a drag route that time, and a pretty good pass protection for Campbell to get his eyes, stretch that defense downfield, and pick up Logan Kennedy on the crossing route. And nice to see Logan into the action here. He had a chance at a really tough catch earlier in the first half, but that's about the first time they've legitimately went his way.
First down at 10 here for the Digs. Ball at the Rocky 33-yard line. Campbell out of the shotgun. Offset eye, handoff, going to go to the deep back. Blake Count's going to try and turn the corner. Gets a block across the 35, down to the 30, but we're going to get a hold call. Going to be a hold out on the edge.
And Coach Sampson doesn't like it, and I don't know if I do either. I didn't see much there on the edge, but the hard part about running wide is you expose so many sets of hands and pads to that that line judge, that, and then you got...
Here's our... They're going to hit out here.
Offense, number 37. Yeah, there isn't much air.
So the holding penalty will go against Charlie Kurgan. Young man out of Missoula Sentinel. Part of that Sentinel dynasty down the road.
Oh, and that's another thing I don't like. I'm calling out the number of the penalty. Well, they don't call them out every time they execute and do it correctly.
Holy
only when they do
man.
Stuff wrong.
We need to get you properly medicated. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm okay. Okay, I'm done.
First, no, you're not. First and 20, Montana Tech. Two receivers left, tight end left. Jet Campbell, who was 13-22 on the day. Handoff, play action. Jet's going to run it. Quarterback design run. He'll slide at the 42 and gets wiped out as he was sliding.
Should get a flag there. He was into his slide and on the ground when he got hit.
So that will bring up second down here for the Digs. Campbell has thrown for 126 yards. He has rushed for 23.
See what they dial up here. Probably going to, I don't even know if they'll go play action. Maybe a straight drop back, but we'll see. Kennedy's in the game at tight end. We'll see if maybe they leave him in for a little extra pass protection here or if they run him into the route because they got the back set his way too.
Kennedy, tight end, left man in motion. Is Wyatt dropping back, late blitz coming. Jet Campbell, that one too far out in front of his tight end that time as the blitz was coming hard.
They had it again, and that's the same concept they ran to Kennedy for the previous first down. They just got runoff, and they got Kennedy dragging across the field, and Campbell just missed him. He got a little too excited, threw it maybe a quarter second too early.
So third down and long here for the Digs. They need to get down to the 26-yard line for the first down. 9 minutes remaining here in the third. We had some big momentum shifts in the first half, but we haven't seen sustained momentum yet today, really. Third down and long.
Yeah, that's a good point. Both teams have had their opportunities, but, the respective defenses have both been playing so good, they've kind of just absorbed and taken away any momentum.
A lot of bodies coming. In trouble, Jet Campbell stands, delivers downfield. That one comes out wounded as he was hit throwing that football. That'll fall incomplete. Come up fourth down here for the Digs.
I like what Jet did there. He got a little bit of pressure. There was some twisting and stunting action in front of him. He got a little excited, and he stepped up. And I think when he stepped up, he didn't realize he had more time than he thought he did, and he got a little excited there and got the ball thrown away. But I think if he keeps his composure maybe a little bit longer, he gets what he wants there because he had Hoffman down around the 25-yard line.
Fourth down and long. Punting unit is in here for the Digs. We'll get you updated on the other scores here in just a moment. 8:55 left to play in the third quarter. Rocky leading 21-13. Snap is good. Kick is away. And it goes out of bounds.
It's going to be about the 5-yard line, I think.
Yeah, we need the yodeler music. We need sound effects. That comes out to the 7-yard line, so another great punt. That's already, I believe, his sixth punt inside the 20-yard line. And we're just three games into this bad boy. 8:48 left to play here in the third. Frontier Conference action here from Bob Green Field. The other score is underway right now. Eastern Oregon leading Carroll 14-10. Southern Oregon leading College of Idaho 14-7. Both of those are in the second quarter. Western up over Northern 28-0. And here in Buttes, the Battling Bears up 21-13.
Yeah, Northern, just on paper, just looking at scores, looks like Northern's improving as the season goes on. Obviously, they're having trouble moving the football and scoring, but Western's no joke on defense, and I'm not saying they're a joke on offense, but I think most of Western's struggles this year have been on the offensive side of the ball, not so much defense.
Which has to be, that's surprising because they return, the guy that had the best numbers from a year ago in John Jones, an incredible quarterback, an offense that just scored on will, it felt like a year ago. So as far as Western goes, it feels like that's the side of the ball that really should have been dominant coming in this year, and it just quite hasn't found its balance point yet.
Yeah, I don't know why. I think they lost quite a bit up front. Tackle. So I think that's probably, let's be honest, that's where the game's played, won and lost.
Well, we're seeing that today. Both sides of the trenches, this has been a battle between the defensive line and the offensive line here in Butte today.
Absolutely.
So as the teams come back out here, Rocky leading 21-13. The Battling Bears, as of today, have run 31 offensive plays for 200 yards. Nathan Dick is 12 of 19 for 101 yards. He's completed 63% of his passes, excuse me. And he'll bring them out. Dick has one back, two receivers up top, one underneath. Handoff going to go on the draw play up the middle. And he'll fight out to the 10-yard line, a gain of three on the ground. I do believe that was Wilcox. So Wilcox with another carry. That'll put him at 61 yards on the day, his 14th carry. Yards have been hard for him to come by today. His longest was 11. It feels like that 3 to 4 yards has kind of been his wheelhouse today.
I can't get a number on Montana Tech's nose tackle. 90-something in on the play that time, making a pile and grabbing legs.
Second down and seven. Nathan Dick will move Wilcox and actually split him out. Dick looking for his tight end, and that one, what a catch by Simon. He went up with one hand and snagged it at the 28. That's a tremendous catch by the big tight end out of Whitehall.
That's where the rules of the games have changed in the consciousness of safety to not come up and take a good shot at Simon. Simon gets to go up on that ball with one hand, knowing he's not going to get hit real hard. No one's coming at his head or upper body, but it was a great catch.
First and 10 here for Nathan Dick. Montana Tech, three down linemen, linebacker just off as well. Long snap count. Dick, play action. Blitz coming. Dick is going to get hit, but get able to get rid of the football out across the 30, down the left sideline with running room and knocked out of bounds at the 45. So what looked like what was going to be a big play for Montana Tech defensively, and Nathan Dick, boy, with his head on a swivel, able to get that off to his tailback, and Wilcox rumbles for great yardage out to the 45.
Yeah, heads up play by Dick. Got the ball released, and Wilcox was able to catch it. Montana Tech defender just took a bad angle on him.
And a handoff going to go to Wilcox on the quick snap again, and he'll get a yard and no more before he is driven to the ground. Second and nine here for the Bears.
And James Newby, Keyshawn James Newby in on the play there. We haven't called Keyshawn's name much today. They must be doing a pretty good job in pass protection because he's a nightmare to try and keep off the quarterback.
Second down and nine.
They've had it. Montana Tech's walked him out in coverage. You can see him doing it with him right now. They got a three-man surface, and he's playing a little more stand-up outside linebacker as well today.
So out of the shotgun, Nathan Dick with one back, two receivers each way. Montana Tech, you see the safeties dropping back. Nathan Dick looking left. Now he's going to be flushed, moves to his right. Still looking to throw. Now he drops it off to his tailback. That's a good play. He was just waiting for the corner and the safety to make a decision where they were going to come at him or just stay in coverage. Once Orvis decides to go after Nathan Dick, he drops it off, and they'll get positive yards to Ben Rooney.
Yeah, he just flipped it out to Ben Rooney. A redshirt freshman, 165-pounder out of Hamilton.
I like that play call, honestly, just kind of waiting for the corner and the safety to make a decision. Once Orvis charges at him, he just drops it off. That's a pickup of six. One back, four receivers again. Montana Tech brings four up to the defensive front, now five. Now they back that fifth out, and they'll bring pressure from five. Nathan Dick in trouble, moving to his left. Way behind the line of scrimmage. Turns the corner, still looking downfield. He'll air it up and throws it out of play. So Nathan Dick airs that one up downfield.
Really good job of getting out of coverage at time by one. I think Wyant came on the inside blitz to help on the pass rush, and then Windauer dropped into the hook to curl. But as Nate Dick escaped out there to the left side, Windauer sold the farm. He came up and forced that throw because it looked like Dick was going to outrun the defensive front there and be able to turn the corner. But it was Windauer coming out of coverage to come help his D front and make Nathan Dick pull up and throw.
So a big stop on third down. Montana Tech will get the football back here as the Rocky punting team comes in. Rockies run 46 offensive plays for 244 yards. We've seen some bend here tonight, but not a whole lot in the way of breakage. Good snap to the punter, and the kick is away. Wobbly kick, fair catch called for and brought into the 18-yard line. So Montana Tech will take over at their 18-yard line.
Good job by McNeil there fielding that. He was brushed by Dylan Baradon a little bit as that ball was coming down, but maintained his focus and was able to field the ball.
So Jet Campbell brings the offense out. He's 13 to 24 on the day, 126 yards. Again, the Digs have turned the ball over twice, and Rocky has gotten 12 points out of those two turnovers, and that's obviously a big factor in this football game to this point.
You have to remind yourself. That's what they're talking about down there on the sideline. Hey, guys, we're a drive away and a two-point conversion away from tying this up. Let's go out. Let's execute. Let's say, you know, especially with this first play. They're talking about this first play and what to expect. And go out and execute and get yourself in a manageable second down position.
So as we get rolling here at the half, Southern leading College of Idaho 14-7. Eastern Oregon up over Carroll College 14-10. And Western is up over Northern 28-0.
I hope they're not listening, but after my takeaway from that Carroll game, and you heard me talk about it, is Carroll doesn't run Perka enough. He's an athletic quarterback.
Yeah.
I think they should, pull the string on him a little bit and say, you know, look to escape and run a little more. I think that offense of theirs would really start to click if he was a little more of a threat running the football, because he's certainly athletic enough to do it.
The one thing that really I came away from that football game, and we've had a lot of games where it doesn't work that way sometimes, but it felt like Carroll was out physical. They lost the physical battle, and that's something I'm not sure I've ever said before, but, you know, that was always one of their calling cards, and that was one of the big things that I came away with that ball game, is Montana Tech won the physical battles at every position. And granted, that could have just been one game. We've certainly seen that before, but that was a big factor in my eyes in that ball game.
Yeah, so they got Hoffman out wide to the left here. Two backs in the backfield. Torgerson, they typically like to throw out of these sets when they bring those receivers in tight.
Tight end in motion here on the near side. Handoff, they're going to run behind it. As Blake with the football across the 20, he's out to the 23-yard line. As Blake counts, will get the carry. Counts 12 carries today, 65 yards on the ground.
Using the tight set that time to just expand the edge, get some angles, and see if they can't get Blake Counts to turn the corner, and he did just that.
Boy, it feels like our conference is awfully good against the run this year. Second down and 6. Be crazy if we got to the end of the year and we didn't have a back averaging over 100 yards a game. Second and 6 here. Out of the shotgun is Campbell once again. Campbell, he's going to hand it off to Counts. Counts turns the corner, hops over one. He pushes his way across the 30 to the 31. First down yardage. Montana Tech running off the left side of their line. As Blake Counts gets right behind Tristan Stauffer, the senior out of Oregon. And that will move the chains.
Yeah, and then I was going to get that pronunciation. How do you say it? Do you say it Seif or Seif?
I believe Seif.
Seif Benjamia out there in front as well.
First down and 10. A little rainfall into the west of us. One back at home, three receivers. And we've got a bunch of motion up front. And this one is probably coming back against Montana Tech, no matter how much you...
Preliminary signs encroachment. I think Schumann just reacted to somebody crossing the line of scrimmage, so the preliminary sign is encroachment on Rocky, so Tech should get a break here and look at first and 5.
Offside, defense, number 95, 5 yards.
And that will be the case. So first and 5 out to the 36-yard line.
Those old front guys plead their case all the time. Occasionally they're right.
I apologize. I read it the wrong way, obviously, right out of the gate. Ooh, bear with me. I have the hiccups. First and 5. One back, three receivers here for the Digs. Tight end left. Hard count. And we're going to get motion right over the football again.
Schumann's having the time of his life. Now what they have to talk about here, and I think they did, but did the defender come all the way across the line? It looked like he did from here.
And that's the case. So another 5 yards will go, and that will move the chains here for Montana Tech. Back-to-back encroachments. Montana Tech trailing by 8, 21-13 to the Battling Bears. The Digs, 2 turnovers. Rocky with 12 points off of those turnovers. And out of the shotgun here, Campbell. Hard snap count. That time they didn't come across. Now Campbell will readjust.
You see the point, and they're identifying. They're going to get maybe a little bit of a pressure package here.
Tight formation on both sides. Campbell will hand it off to Blake Counts. Counts going to get hit behind the line of scrimmage. He'll get back to the line of scrimmage and not much more. An awful lot of white jerseys in there to make contact. One of the first there was Ethan Hurst, D lineman out of California.
Yeah, you start maybe, you know, they've actually put Campbell in a couple design runs today. They're probably talking about it there. That play, even though Counts got stood up a little bit and slowed down, that play was essentially stopped from the backside here. And then that's the guy you want to control with your quarterback.
Second down and 10 here for the Digs. Ball at the 41-yard line, man in motion. Dropping back, looking to throw off the play action. Ball is loose. It's on the ground. He went to throw that football, and it came out. Rocky saying they have it. No, now they do. We get a signal. The ball goes to the Battling Bears. That ball was stripped away from Jet Campbell.
Yeah, as Campbell stepped up and was getting ready to release it, Wes Moea, 6'3", 315-pounder, stripped him from behind.
So the third turnover of the day will give the football to Rocky Mountain College at the 34-yard line. And the Bears lead by 8 with 3:32 left to play here in this football game. They have 12 points off of turnovers thus far, and they'll look to add to that here.
Defense is in a good rhythm here. He got to come out and get a stop, get a three and out, and a big decision out of that Rocky offense.
Nathan Dick is 15 to 23 on the day for 141 yards. He has one back at home, three receivers here on the short side of the field. Or I guess on the right side of the field, I should say. Hand off to the tailback, Wilcox gets hammered at the line of scrimmage.
There he is.
That's James Newby.
Yeah, that's James Newby. A lot similar to a lot of the plays he made against Carroll College's zone running attack, chasing it down from the back.
Second down and 10 here for the Bears as they look to the sidelines. Again, remember Nathan Dick came out of the end of that game against College of Idaho with a foot injury of some type, was in a walking boot, it sounds like, most of the last 2 weeks. Isn't listed on the depth chart at all on the two deep. Wilcox will release. They look at him. Now Dick is going to run. Boy, he sold that well. He can get down to the 30-yard line, a gain of 4. You know, he looked at Wilcox looking to get him that football. It felt like forever, and then on the design run, takes it right up the gut, brings up third down and 6 here for the Bears.
Yeah, he demonstrated some real patience in that play. And again, you know, when he takes off to run, that Tech defense, that's got to be an 0-3 alert and get helmets to the football and inflict a little punishment.
Nathan Dick, handoff to Wilcox. He'll stretch the edge. He gets turned upfield. Boy, thought we might get a holdout on the edge. Wilcox is going to get first down yardage at the 22. It looked like one of the receivers on that side grabbed a couple handfuls of jersey to try and make him get that corner. And that is first down yardage here for the Bears. 2:13 left to play here in the third. A fresh set of downs for the Battling Bears. This is their 50th offensive play. They've gone for 248 yards. Wilcox releases left. And they set up screen the other way. Pass caught and hammered.
Good read by Harmer that time. Naoki Harmer coming up, reading the screen. It was a good play call. They just never got a hat on Harmer for the tunnel screen receiver, you know, to even get a break. Montana Tech brought a little pressure, and Rocky delivered the ball right into it.
Boy, it felt like he was in the huddle. I mean, Harmer just was an absolute bullet on that play. Second and 12. And that's one of those plays that takes a long time to develop. When you fake pass a screen out to the left and then come back to the tunnel screen, that's a lot of time. Second and 12, split backs, three receivers. He'll send man in motion. They want to get it to him. Now he'll look downfield. Pass complete. Very close to first down yardage, if not there. And that's going to come up about a yard shy. Another good-looking play that time as the receiver out there was Trey Henry. Sophomore out of Idaho Falls will get the catch.
Washington come up limping, twisted his ankle over there on the sideline. Rocky's going to be looking at third and 2 here and probably 4 down territory.
I was going to ask if the last third down was 4 down territory or not, but this you'd have to assume is. Trainers will make their way over. The Rocky coaching staff were the first ones there to help Washington as he went down.
So Montana Tech running Matt Wickham off the game and Cole Wyant back into the game. Wyant's have been on the sidelines for the bulk of this drive. They had Allred in at the other inside backer along with Windauer. Now Wyant's back in the action.
Diggs trying to find some sort of momentum here today. We just haven't seen it to this point. like I say, we've seen big momentum shifts with turnovers and the block PATs, things that really kind of get going, but no sustained momentum out of either team. Rocky has put together a couple of nice drives, but turnovers have been their big factor today. They have taken the ball away three times from Montana Tech. The Digs had not turned the ball over yet coming into this football game. And that has certainly been kind of the tail of the tape. Otherwise, it has been absolute dogfight in the trenches between the O fronts and the D fronts.
Yeah, it has.
So Washington able to get up and make his way under his own power. Other scores being delivered here from Commissioner Paulson.
Oh, actually, that might be Sanchez.
Oh, I think you're right. It is.
Seeing the difference between the 5 and the zero, I think Angel wears number 0. I can, you know, when they get up and walk, I can tell because Angel Sanchez is a little more bow-legged.
and
that's what I look for.
He's large too.
Yeah.
I mean, he's one of the he has packed on some muscle. Third down and 2. Sanchez does come to the sideline under his own power. Good to see there. Nathan Dick out of the shotgun. One back, 4 receivers. Tech presents a 4-man front. Dick is going to keep it himself straight ahead. He fights his way across the 10 down to the 8. First and goal here for the Battling Bears.
That's more like it, though, Montana Tech. Even though he got the first down, they got a few hats there and laid some pads on Nathan Dick, maybe to discourage him a little bit from that running action.
First and goal here for the Bears. Montana Tech won both of the meetings last year. They will play again later this year. And up to the line of scrimmage, Dick out of the shotgun. Hard snap count, almost gets him across. Now they look to the sideline. Now we get flags flying on both sides.
Looks like Allred lost his balance there.
I think that was kind of the case. Is the initial move and then offsides on the defense.
Half the distance to the goal. Still first down.
So we've seen more encroachments today than we have seen.
Yeah,
the offense jumping, which
that's clearly a reaction to what Rocky Mountain College watched Montana Tech do on the previous series. 2 plays in a row, getting in the encroachment, and then you're all of a sudden you're over there saying, hey, let's us mix up the snap count a little bit and see if we can't get Montana Tech to do the same thing.
First and goal just inside the 5. 1 back, 4 receivers. Nathan Dick keeps it himself straight ahead to the 3. He gets hit hard, but boy, he's just... When he goes, he's another one of those that doesn't get negative yards. Like, he's always falling forward. He's always picking the right lane. He makes really good decisions with the football.
Well, I don't know if that was the plan coming in, but they know that the rush yards have been tough to get against this Montana Tech defense, so they've just taken it to that last step, right? And so now they've got 10 guys out there trying to get a pad on somebody, and they're getting 1 lead blocker there for their quarterback who's got he's a willing participant in the running game, and now all of a sudden your numbers advantage on defense are gone.
Well, and we go to the final quarter, ladies and gentlemen. 15 minutes remaining in this football game, and what we've seen in the first 3 quarters, I have no idea what's on tap for the final 15 minutes. We'll take a break. We'll come back with the start of the 4th quarter right after this.
I chose engineering because I've always liked tinkering, and engineering fits right in. You take a problem and come up with a solution and figure out how things work.
For me, choosing Montana Tech for my mechanical engineering degree was not only the right thing to do, but it was the best thing to do.
Mechanical is filled with great job opportunities and has so much potential growth.
Our students walk out with really high-paying jobs.
Tech has given me the opportunity to pursue what I want and get the education that I really needed.
Join us for Day One, Montana Tech's 2nd annual giving event. Day One celebrates our history and our growth, bringing together our Montana Tech community to share what's happening on our campus and raise funds for our departments and programs. For more information or to sign up as an ambassador, visit dayone.mtech.edu.
Hey, welcome back here once again, Montana Tech. 4th quarter ready to roll. An 8-point lead for the Battling Bears as they will come up to the line of scrimmage. 2nd down and goal from the 3. So Dick will put 3 receivers left, tight end left. Heavy formation here on the bottom side of the screen. Out of the shotgun, Dick going to go straight ahead. Bounces left. Nathan Dick is going to get in for the score. So Nathan Dick will clear the corner. He gets in for 6. So with that, three turnovers on the day for Montana Tech have resulted in 18 points for the Battling Bears.
It appears to be the plan now, right?
Yeah,
a lot of Nathan Dick just off tackle left and right, getting one lead blocker. And he does a nice job of seeing where he's going with the football. He started inside there and bounced it outside, found a seam, and got in the end zone.
Showing no sign of any kind of injury. He is playing awfully well today. The kick is up, and the kick is through. So 28-13 our score, a two-possession ball game as the Battling Bears up over Montana Tech here at Bob Green Field Alumni Coliseum. Taking a look at the team numbers, Rocky now 55 offensive plays, 274 yards. Nathan Dick has completed 68% of his passes. He's 17-25 for 149 yards. He has also run the ball 11 times for 53 yards. He has two touchdowns on the ground today as well.
I'd like to know how many first downs he's ran for.
Yeah.
You know, a big plays, like, you know, yep, third and short, fourth and short, down there on the goal line. Yeah, he's it's clear what they want to do now, you know, and it kind of reminds me of what Western did quite a bit last year with Jund. You know, when they would struggle to run the football and they needed yards, you saw them do it all the way into their playoff run. They would use that back as a lead blocker, and they were just running off tackle left and right with Shane Jund. John Jund.
So that will bring the ball out. Montana Tech trailing by two scores as this fourth quarter gets underway. The Digs offense needs to get moving here. End over end kick. Return will start at the goal line. Down the right hash mark, now toward the center of the field. Gets past one defender, cuts back here on the near side. Some running room. Torgerson, 25 out to the 30. Hand down and out of bounds at the 34.
Good job of staying on his feet and changing direction. Kyle Torgerson, nothing there to the design side of that return, but got his change of direction and out around the corner and got Montana Tech in pretty good business here out near the 35-yard line.
And he uses that pivot hand so well. You know, he's one of those guys that when he gets low, he's able to put the hand down, keep his balance.
I can't reach the ground anymore without taking a knee. I just can't. You know what I mean?
Yep.
And you watch these guys do it and really not even break stride.
Just underway here in the fourth quarter. Montana Tech has run 51 offensive plays for 210 yards. They have 126 yards through the air off the hand of Jet Campbell. He's completed 54% of his passes. They have 84 yards on the ground here today. I'm
trying to think of some guys that were really good at that. Jay LaProwse was really good. Both Josh and Justin Johnston. Where were they from? Frenchtown?
That sounds right.
You remember Josh, the one set the single game rushing record
against Northern? Ran for 3
out. All those guys could get that hand down. And they work on it all the time.
Montana Tech
Coach
is a place for opportunity and innovation.
I constantly saw
where determined doers thrive.
Individual work.
Montana Tech Athletics
like
is committed to providing
transformative experiences
doesn't it
feel like that's another group that has
while striving
really
for excellence
good
across
that,
all
know, knowing their center of balance at
our
a low
goal
point
is to enrich and expand our programs and facilities while delivering the one-on-one
conference. Let me check my scores from the commission.
As we look
Rocky
forward,
College,
we're
you know
excited to embrace growth
Western
and are driven
Northern
to provide a championship experience
the quarter,
for our student athletes,
over the
our campus, our
fans,
and our
Eastern Oregon leading
we have a vision
College
for the future of Montana Tech Athletics and cannot
that's
wait to
Rocky's
share more throughout the season.
He's listed as a D lineman on that return, walking off under his own power now, banged up a little bit on the play. It's Tarek Pennington, 6'2", 215-pound freshman out of Nampa, Idaho.
So again, thanks for joining us here on a Saturday. Montana Tech needing some momentum here. One of the top offenses in the country came in number 23 in yards.
Rocky's done a nice job on them defensively. They've
really
done a
have
really nice job here today.
You know, you brought up that when Jet Campbell has time to throw, he is as accurate as anyone. He hasn't had much time to throw the football today.
Yeah, you're right. He's just as, you know, other than just a couple times, he's never really looked comfortable in there. You know, a couple of his big completions were, you know, just uncomfortable, kind of sidearming the ball out of the pocket.
First down and 10 here for the Digs. One back, three receivers, trailing by two scores. Rocky showing blitz. Here it comes. Jet Campbell airs it up right side. Pass complete. Out across the 40, out to the 43-yard line. As with the reception, going to be Wyatt Alexander. Junior will haul it in. Alexander, that's his second catch of the afternoon. 20 yards receiving.
Good look, and another pressure package. Rocky's defensive front slanted hard to this boundary side, and they looped a couple linebackers off the wide side of the field. Montana Tech picked it up pretty good and at least gave Campbell time to get Alexander one-on-one against, it looks like, Butler out here, or excuse me, Kaysen Barnett.
Handoff straight ahead. Caleb Winterburn will be real close to first down yardage.
Yeah, it depends on which mark they use. They're going to be real close to the top side. Looks like he's marking third down. Yep.
So third down and short here for the Digs. Just underway here in the fourth quarter. Montana Tech not going to change out any personnel here. Alexander at receiver at the bottom. You see Hoffman, and he'll look to his – actually, they will change it out. Alexander will go out. We're going to get a fullback into the ball game. Lander Smith looks like he'll check in.
I think this would be a good time. They're good. They're looking pretty heavy there, and Rocky's got a lot of bodies at the line of scrimmage. This would be a good time for play action.
Man in motion is Torgerson. They play action it to him. They're going to throw the football. Moving right, Jet Campbell. Pump fake once. Campbell in trouble. He gets a good block. First down yardage across the 45. Great block that time. Coming back to help out his quarterback was Caleb Winterburn. He throws up the block, and that is the reason they're going to get a fresh set of downs.
He had Hoffman to the top side. Hoffman made his break on the post route right at about the 40-yard line going in, but he had a little bit of action in front of him. Probably couldn't pick up Hoffman. Hoffman had the separation he needed, that's for sure.
First down and 10 here for the Digs. Rocky will change out some personnel quickly. Campbell out of the shotgun, tight end in motion. Stops on the right. They're going to swing it out quickly to Hoffman. Hoffman gets one step forward, and he's out of bounds at the 45.
Yeah, start to extend that running game. Just some quick hitters out front. He used Torgerson as a lead blocker just to literally throw it to Hoffman out of his stance and let him go get what he can get. Hoffman's a load now. He's not necessarily really easy for the cornerbacks and safeties of the world to get to the ground.
I like that, too, where Hoffman took a drop step but then started moving downfield before he caught that football. He didn't catch it going backwards, which certainly is a huge benefit. Second down and 4. Tight end in motion. Handoff going to go to the back. Blake Counts has some running room. Counts gets the edge. Counts down near the 40. Stiff arm out of bounds and on the ground at the 39-yard line. A gain of 6, and a late flag comes in.
Good tackle by Klein that time. He came up. You know, he just had one-on-one with Counts there. He got up into the lower legs of Counts and got him into the ground.
So let's see what we have here.
Once again, that play, if it's a hold, I think it would be kind of one of those pointless hold calls, you know, that was behind the, you know, way behind the play, because all the stuff was executed good to the wide side of the field from Montana Tech.
So our white hat, and it is going to be a hold against Montana Tech.
Still second down.
So the Digs called with the hold, and that will back them up. That's their fourth holding penalty here today.
You know,
what was a fresh set of downs now comes back 10.
25 years ago, you know, they kind of made it, you know, kind of a change there. You know, it's a, you know, did the hold create an advantage for the offense or not? You know, and eat that flag and maybe just talk to the player. I don't know if that's still something they talk about in their Monday night meetings.
Second and 8, one back. Blitz coming again. Campbell flushed out of the pocket to his right. He's going to run the whole way. He's across midfield, 45-40, out of bounds at the 39-yard line. That's going to be a pickup of 14 for the quarterback and move the chains here for the Digs.
Yeah, good job out there in space, guys. You know, looking for a helmet to get on and block without holding. And Campbell's got the athleticism to get out and turn the corner against this defense. He's shown it many times today, and he's using that as just another facet of this offense.
First down and 10 here for the Digs. Nice run by the quarterback as he was flushed. Rocky bringing a lot more in the way of blitz packages here as this ball game goes on. First down and 10. Campbell changing the play. Moves his tailback, Caleb Winterburn, to his left. Tight end comes in motion. Hand off to Winterburn. He'll try and turn it upfield. And, boy, there's not much there. They ran to the short side of the field. And the good pursuit by Rocky does not give him any opportunity to move it up. That's going to bring up second and nearly 10.
Yeah, Kyle Frazier did a nice job there, number 15, playing linebacker. He kind of got knocked to the ground a little bit at the line of scrimmage, and he stumbled and stayed on his feet and forced Winterburn out of bounds. You know, he ran, you know, off balance, ran about, you know, 15 yards to the sideline, forcing Winterburn out of bounds.
Second down and 10 here for the Digs. Again, trailing by 15 points. Fourth quarter action. Jet Campbell. Two receivers up top, one here on the near side looking to throw. Campbell in the pocket, airs it up downfield. Collision, that one is going to fall incomplete. White Alexander came back on the comeback route, the button hook it out near the 30-yard line, and that one just too far in front of him. Brings up third down and 9 here for the Digs.
Well, if Campbell could put the ball on the string, they're getting a lot of situations to the wide side of the field where they can get two verticals on one safety on that far hash mark. But it requires kind of a, you know, a pass that's touched up enough to clear the underneath coverage, but on a rope enough to that, you know, so that safety can't react really well to it. But they've had that situation many times here.
Campbell completing 55% of his passes today. Blitz coming. Campbell stands, delivers, pass through his intended target's hands, incomplete. That'll bring up fourth down.
Kind of no man's land here. I guess Montana Tech, 11 and a half minutes to go in the fourth quarter. I like a punt here, field position type thing, but, you know, it's also, you know, a situation they may feel like they have to go for it, and it looks like they're...
Yeah, the offense never wavered. So the offense will stay out. They're going to run three receivers left, one to the right. Hoffman here on the bottom of your screen. Jordan Jackson all the way at the top of your screen.
Rocky's going to give them plenty up front. They got everybody in a two-point. They're going to try and cause some confusion and probably bring about five, and they did.
Blitz coming, in trouble, and quarterback in trouble, trying to get rid of it here. Air it up, and it's intercepted at the 34-yard line. So picked off. And Rocky will have the football at the 34-yard line, which in that situation ends up a heck of a lot better than giving up the sack. If he gets sacked, he's out in your midfield. It's picked off. They get it down to 34.
The interception gains him 5 yards, actually. Montana Tech, not that it was a great decision, but he was able to escape and get rid of the football.
So that will go to the Battling Bears.
Now the trouble becomes stopping this. Kind of this quarterback running 3 yards in a cloud of dust, or 4 yards in a cloud of dust, because that's what it's kind of navigated into this last couple drives. And obviously Montana Tech didn't stop it on the last series, but it's just tough to keep him from gaining a couple yards.
First down and 10, hand off to the tailback and Wilcox. He's tripped up. Nice open field tackle that time.
That's Harmer. He made a lot of ground, started about 11 yards deep and came downhill and made the tackle for just a short gain. Looked like a lot more room there when he's handed the ball, didn't it?
Truly did. Harmer makes a nice play on that. Eastern leading Carroll 14-10 in the third. Southern and the College of Idaho are tied up 14-all. And Western leading Northern 35-6 are other games.
Rocky's really starting to milk clock here.
Rain coming down here in the Mining City. Everybody running for cover and digging out umbrellas. 10:40 left to play here in this football game.
Last couple days of rain have really helped in clearing the air and the smoke around here.
It has. Second down and 7. Man in motion. Two receivers up top. One here on the near side. Handoff going to go to Wilcox, and we're going to get a timeout. Looks like Rocky called a timeout, I believe, before the play clock hit zero. Because that one took a little while to get rolling. 10:29 left to play here in the football game. 4 turnovers on the day for Montana Tech. The first 3 turnovers have gone for 6 points each. Rocky with the football here, working on this 4th turnover. We had rain to the west of us through the bulk of this football game. Now it's starting to come our way.
Montana Tech is a place for opportunity and innovation.
Doesn't look like it's
gonna
hang
around. Where determined doers thrive.
About 5 minutes worth.
Montana Tech Athletics is committed to providing transformative experiences
for our
students
here on a Saturday.
While striving for excellence
right now,
all programs.
Has run 56
our goal is to
enrich
and expand our programs and facilities while delivering the one-on-one attention and family environment that's a hallmark for Montana Tech. As we look forward, we're excited to embrace growth and are driven to provide a championship experience for our student-athletes, our campus, our fans, and our community. We have a vision for the future of Montana Tech Athletics and cannot wait to share it throughout the season.
A lot of people heading out to the tailgate.
You know, it's one thing if you're one of those dynamic, quick-strike offenses that occasionally turns the ball over, but... neither one of these teams really do that. You know, it's not necessarily part of their identity.
Second down and 7 here for the Bears after their timeout. Bears with 2 timeouts remaining. Montana Tech with 3. Diggs need a stop here and get that football back. So we get the whistle and we're ready to roll. Nathan Dick out of the shotgun. 2 receivers up top. Simon goes in motion. He'll stop just inside the slot. Tailback moves over as well. Nathan Dick going to run straight ahead. He gets through the first level, bounces right, slides at the 43, just shy of the first down marker.
He's kind of kicking himself. He went into the slide, and as he started to get up, he looked and realized he started to slide about a yard short of the first down mark. So Rocky's got a big third down here in Montana Tech. You just got to answer the call here. You got plenty of time. 10 minutes left in this game. You're down two scores, but you need a big stop here. The thing that Montana Tech's done defensively in a lot of these short yardage situations is they haven't had a lot of helmets on the line of scrimmage, you know, either a three or four-man front, even down on the goal line. I thought maybe they'd walk six up. They had four down. And looks like they're just going to give them a four-man surface here as well.
Third down and one here for the Battling Bears. Tailback goes in motion. Wilcox, Dick is going to keep it. He vaults off of his own guy and spins across the 45 and moves the chain. So, again, looked like another situation where Tech was going to get pressure, and he is able to spin out and get positive yards.
Yeah, he's doing a good job of finding that a little bit of space after first contact, and he's done that quite a bit here today. That time, Montana Tech at the you know, where that play was designed, they blew it up, but Dick was able to just slam his helmet in there, stay on his feet, spin out, and get the first down.
Nathan Dick, 13 carries, 59 yards on the day. Rocky has rushed for 137 yards total. And again, they'll eat some of the clock here as they come up to the line of scrimmage. First down and 10, Bears at their 46-yard line. They lead by two scores. Three receivers here on the bottom. Hand off to his tailback, Wilcox, stretching the edge. He's across the 50, 45, down to the 44. He's one that has tricky speed. He gets to that edge, and it feels like guys have trouble getting the right angle on him because he beats guys to the point of impact.
Yeah, and he's getting they do a nice job out front. You know, they're a little different looking receiving crew that time. Joseph Dwyer, I mean, he's only 5'8", 160 pounds, but, you know, he's providing that edge blocking. And the tough part about stock blocking as a receiver is you've got to maintain that block for, you know, more than a couple seconds. And he does a nice job in that case. He's matched up against a physical corner here, Jordan Washington, and he maintained the block and allowed Wilcox to turn the corner.
Second down and one here for the Bears as they hustle up to the line of scrimmage. Ball at the Montana Tech 45. Tailback releases. Dick is going to keep it again. He goes straight ahead. He gets hit hard, but again, he gets first down yardage. He needed one. He gets two. Clock will continue to roll once they set the chains. So the Digs trailing 28-13. Rocky with 18 points off of three turnovers. This possession coming off a turnover as well. They're looking to add to that total.
Yeah, any back at this point in the game, you know, so often back motion out of the backfield has been quarterback run, and it's almost 100% now.
First down and 10, two receivers each way for Nathan Dick. Montana Tech puts three on the defensive front. Hand off to Wilcox. Wilcox puts a hand down. He gets out to the 40. They'll give him three on the carry. So, again, some yards and, more importantly, time ticking away.
Yeah, it's certainly stop time for this Montana Tech defense. You know, got a little bit of fresh rain on the field, a little water on the football. I doubt Rocky puts this ball in the air. Of course, I've been wrong about 100% of the time today, but I doubt they put it in the air. I would almost bet my game check that you're going to see motion out of the backfield here and Dick up the middle.
Second down and eight. Two receivers up top, one on the bottom here. Montana Tech bringing four up to the line of scrimmage. Pressure coming. Wilcox does not get through the first level. It looked like he was going to spin through. Nice job by that Digger D up front, able to hold on to and spin him down.
Yeah, Tech defense has done a good job. Yeah, but frankly, they've done a pretty good job on Dick today, actually, for running the football. But I tell you what, when it's just, you know, that the difference in a yard, you know, 3 or 4 or like 4 yards a carry versus 3 yards a carry has been the difference today.
Well, you look at, if I tell you that you're going to hold Nathan Dick to 210 total yards, you're going to be happy with
that. Yeah.
He's got 150 yards passing, 60 yards on the ground.
You got to keep your head here, know your assignment, do your job defensively. This is it for this Tech defense right here, this play.
Third down and eight. Wilcox moves to the bottom. Out of the shotgun, Wilcox will get the football, and he'll get destroyed. That's going to be a loss of five as he is met violently, and Montana Tech will bring up a fourth down. Big-time play, Zach Trumbull.
Yeah, Trumbull got upfield, read that outside stretch play real quick, and just, you know, he beat his old lineman big time.
Trumbull's a large man.
He is. He's a big, strong, good player, and he's been a really good player for a couple years that they talk, you know, when you hear that the players talk amongst themselves about impact players on that defense, they've talked about him since he's arrived here.
Fourth down, and the punting unit comes in, so the Rocky Mountain College Bears eat like 8 minutes of clock here.
Just a junior.
And Montana's snap is low. He's able to dig it out. The punt is away. There is contact. Are we going to get a roughing or a running into? So the return here on the right side across the 10, 15, 20, 25 out near the 30. Torgerson out to the 40, and he gets hit going out of bounds. And now we're going to get another flag. So we'll see if it's roughing or running into. This does not look good for Tech. I think we're going to get a roughing the kicker here.
Well, is there a difference?
A 5 and a 15-yard variety.
This will be running into then.
That was my initial thought, but, boy, I don't know.
This will be running into because, you know, the kicker was on the ground, and he was just literally kind of almost like shoulder to chest bumped a little bit and sold it well. Bresvin sold it well. But it's going to be interesting to see what happened down here on the sideline, if they're ruling that Torgerson got hit after he stepped out of bounds, or if there was some kind of
something
after the play altercation within the sideline here on the Montana Tech side.
So our white hat will discuss it here. 5:30 left to play here in the football game. Montana Tech trailing by 15. We'll get you updated on the other scores underway as well.
Because this, I believe, will be a post-snap foul and will be enforced regardless.
One live ball, one dead ball. Both of them will be enforced. Roughing the kicker.
Yeah, we can't get an idea what we're getting here from the official.
Late hit out of bounds.
He's not made any hand signals yet.
That'll be 15 yards from that spot. It will be first down.
So first down, so it is roughing.
Did he call roughing? I never saw him signal anything. I think
he just signaled first down.
I think he might have washed that flag and enforced this one. I think something happened down on the Tech sideline.
The Tech defense is coming back out. So yeah. Rocky has a fresh set of downs here. Rocky's offense is back out onto the field. So he had to hit roughing the kicker.
Well, there was another flag down here. Did you see that?
So there was one after the fact, right? Was there another one? So, but that would have been
something
after the...
Both were enforced in some facet here, right?
Yeah, that certainly must have been the case, because otherwise roughing would have been 15 yards forward. But a fresh set of downs for Rocky. So it wasn't running into, it was roughing, so they get an automatic first down. And then the penalty against Rocky after the fact puts the football at the 45-yard line.
Yeah, that would make the most sense, because this is where that previous play started, right?
Yep. So a fresh set of downs here for the Battling Bears. Montana Tech looked as though they were going to get the football back. Winds have really picked up heavily out of the north here right now.
The official didn't use any of his signals.
Nothing. He just the only thing he said was first down. He gave me the chop for first down. So fresh set of downs here for Nathan Dick. That is a costly, costly penalty. And the handoff will go straight ahead. Not much there, but that isn't the point. The clock is the point here as it is rumbling down. They'll snap the next one under 5 minutes remaining. So when it looked like the Digs were going to have the football with about 5.5 remaining, now they won't get the football back until about the 3-minute mark at best. So turnovers have just absolutely kicked Montana Tech here today. They've turned the ball over 4 times. Rocky has scored 3 touchdowns on those 4 turnovers. And again, we're still on this series. This would be the 4th turnover series here. 2nd and 10, Nathan Dick going to keep it. He runs into his own man, keeps his feet moving. He'll get down to the 43.
Yeah, they're really starting, you know, to absolutely disregard Rocky throwing the football here. That time, the first two guys in the backfield were Washington and Morley. You know, Morley's the safety. Washington's the right corner. They're just letting their guys go. Trying to help against that running game.
3rd down and 7 here for the Bears. Clock running. Down to 4:10 left to play. The play clock at 15. And not burning as much the play clock as I would have expected, honestly. So 3rd down and 8, hard count. Did the Digs get across or did?
No, the Tech's across, Tech's across. They're gonna be down to about 3rd and 3 here.
That will be the case.
Which brings into play the play that Rocky wants to run anyway. It's probably going to be Dick off the left or right side. See if he can't hit, make contact, spin, stumble for a first down.
3rd down and 4 officially here for the Bears. 1 back, 2 receivers on each side. Rocky leading 28-13. Nathan Dick looks over to his offensive coach for the call. Play clock now down to 10. Third down and 4. Hand off to Wilcox. Fakes. Going to throw it. Pass is incomplete.
Well, that's a break for Montana Tech. Getting an incomplete pass. Yep. The clock stops. Rocky's more than likely going to punt this ball.
So with 3:37 remaining in the football game, Montana Tech trailing by 2 scores needs a quick one here. Other scores in the fourth quarter, Western over Northern, 35-6. Third quarter, College of Idaho and Southern are tied up 14 apiece. And in the third quarter, Eastern leading Carroll 14-10. So fourth down, the punting unit comes in for the Battling Bears. Bears looking to go to 2-1 in Frontier Conference play. As the punting unit is in, and instead of rollout this time, stays straight up. End over end kick, fair catch, called for at the 4 and down at the 2. Bobbled.
I think it got
across.
Did
it break the plane?
Yep.
The official saying it did. So that is a big break for Montana Tech. Instead of the ball at the 2-yard line, it will come out.
Great decision by Torgerson. Looked like he was going to try and fair catch that ball. Let it bounce. Got a cherry hop for Rocky to down it, and they just misplayed the ball. They went to catch it and down it on the 2-yard line, fumbled it into the end zone.
3:26 left to play here in this football game. And again, Montana Tech needs to do some work here. Jet Campbell is 15-29 for 140 yards. He has completed 51% of his passes. Hoffman has 6 catches, Torgerson with 5. And the Digs trailing by 2 scores. Again, you know, we've seen a couple really, Rocky has had some real sustained drives here today. But again, we haven't seen any kind of monumental emotional runs. You know, we've seen kind of some quick hitters back and forth, but nobody really has grabbed the momentum in this football game and carried it away for any length of time.
Nobody has sequenced 2 big plays together back-to-back,
yep,
like throughout the whole game. You know, there's just been no offensive rhythm out of either offense.
Agreed. So the Digs, again, clock working against them here. 3:26 left to play in the ball game. Digs are on the road at Western next week, as the Bulldogs will entertain the Digs. That's certainly always another one to look forward to. As the offense huddled up, chatting things over with the coaching staff. 15-point lead here for Rocky. And as we've talked about, turnovers just have been the tail of the tape today.
Yes, they have.
So the officials put the football down, and we are ready to roll here.
These media timeouts get long, don't they?
The Digs out.
I hope the advertising blocks are filled.
That's the deal.
That's the deal.
One back, 2 receivers on each side of the formation for Jet Campbell. Rocky has given him constant pressure all day today. Campbell. 4-man pressure coming. Campbell airs it up right side, bobbled and dropped. Unable to hold on to it on that far side. That one will hit the turf.
That looked like Jackson out there.
Looks like that's the case. So Jordan Jackson unable to make that catch. Brings up 2nd down and 10 here for the Digs. Southern Oregon now goes up 17-14 over the College of Idaho. That would make things real interesting too. 2nd down and 10. 3-step drop, pass, big time reach out to make that, and they'll say he got it on the ground. Wyatt Alexander went completely parallel to the ground, made the catch, but came down and the football made contact with the turf while he had his hands on it, and that's ruled incomplete.
Yeah, he had it for a split second, but then when his arms hit the ground, it shook the ball loose a little bit.
3rd down and 10 here for the Digs. A 15-point lead for the Bears. Jed Campbell brings man in motion. Hoffman will stop underneath the slot. Crossing route, rolling out. Campbell is going to run. Gets past one defender and out of bounds. No, fakes going out of bounds and gets across the 30 out to the 32. That's first down yardage.
Yeah.
Heads up play by the quarterback to move the chains.
He wanted that first down for sure. You know, he didn't want the pressure of a 4th down situation there. So he cut it. He cut it up.
That felt like the pit fake slide there for a second. He showed that he was going to go out of bounds and kept his feet and stayed in bounds. Fresh set of downs, 3 minutes left to play. One back, 4 receivers. Dropping back, Campbell going to air it up. Hoffman with the catch out to the 42, and he'll get chopped down. Hoffman, catch number 7 today.
That's what I mean. Cornerback at that time, Case and Barnett just came up and put a shot on Hoffman. You know, fairly benign play and tackle. But Hoffman, 215 pounds, it looked like he ran into a wall. He shook up a little bit.
Yeah. Might have got himself a little stinger, something there, as he will get up slowly and make his way to the sidelines.
We'll see who they run out here and see if Montana Tech doesn't go right that direction with the football.
2:47 left to play here in the football game. Montana Tech down by 2 scores. As they'll get up to the line of scrimmage, slowly take the player off the field.
So far, there's nobody.
Yeah.
They're running. Holy cow. Now, this is a good size.
Shamar Whetstone. Whetstone, 235, a junior at corner. Second down and 1. Look, dropping back, airs it up, has a man. Wyatt Alexander at the 25, down to the 22.
They did go that direction, that's for sure. They clouded the new corner. I mean, Whetstone, 6 foot, 235. He was mainly playing just a flat defender, so almost like a outside linebacker that went into his drop. And Montana Tech got that 2-on-1 versus near side safety that we were talking about earlier here in the first half, or
Hoffman,
the second half.
Hoffman, your bottom receiver. Alexander inside him, 1 back at home. Dropping back, stepping up, now looking to run. Quarterback off, across the 15-10, little shuck and jive down to the 5-yard line. And he'll be deposited there. First and goal from the 5 here for the Digs. Jet Campbell with the run.
Yeah, Montana Tech, a score here goes a long way. They still have all 3 timeouts, so they can kick the ball off if they score here.
Quickly up to the line of scrimmage, the Digs trying to get something signaled in, and now we're going to get another injured player down for Rocky. 2:25 left to play here in this football game.
Quite a few players banged up here today.
Yeah, and this is our corner that just came in, gets up slowly.
And now
Shamar Whetstone.
Yeah, looks like Kason Barnett is running. He's okay. He walked off the field under his own power after he got injured earlier in this series. Now he's back.
And Whetstone will be able to jog off the field. First and goal from the 5. 2:25 left to play here in the football game. Montana Tech looking to put some points here and see how this one shakes out. 1 back as Blake counts, 3 receivers left.
Tech's got what they want here. They're going to see zone coverage here on the goal line.
Slot in motion. Wyatt Alexander was the man in motion. Dropping back. They're going to swing it out. Pass completes, and Blake gets inside. Blake counts for 6. He'll get the pass and the touchdown. Blake counts inside the pylon. Great body control by Counts that time to keep the football inside the pylon. The Digs put 6 up.
Good job leading out there. Logan Kennedy getting a block, and Torgerson up there in the end zone. Just enough for Counts to comfortably catch the ball, get his shoulders to the goal line, and get across.
So the kicking unit is in here for the Digs. Trailing by 9.
Extra point. I mean,
that it is.
Certainly want to see this go.
Snap and hold are good. The kick is up. Boy, Rocky gets good pressure, but the kick. So, and 28-20, our score. 2:11 left to play here in this game.
I'm going to put an onside kick. I'm saying no.
With 3 timeouts, they will?
I don't think so. Good job defensively of keeping Rocky at bay. They absolutely know they're going to be running the football. So, I think this ball gets kicked away.
Okay? I'll go with you. And like I say, 3 timeouts. If they do keep it on the ground and they keep them from moving the chains, they will get the football back. So we'll see what this presents here for Montana.
They won't kick the onside kick. Just maybe just, you know, a soft wedge, maybe a little 60 degree.
Thank you.
Wedge.
It's taken this.
Yeah, just a nice little soft wedge. The throw-up zone, we call it.
I was going to say, we can't make Phil jokes anymore, can we? Is that off limits now?
Who?
Mickle, exactly. With Mickelson wedges, is that off?
Oh. the 40, 30 yards.
And knock it up. It's fielded, and it's going to be not to that.
You're going to see. Take a deep. There was no one down.
Rocky will have the football. 48 yards.
Fair catch. A fair caught. They had to signal.
All right, so
that was Kate Simmons' first down.
Was the, I think you're right.
He turned
actually,
the onside
yeah,
kick.
Turned out. Rocky will come in. Montana Tech. Mounts. Nathan Dick. Out of the. To his right. Leans forward for. Blocking. This has been an absolute battle in the trenches. I mean, both sides really have done a good job today. So Tech will call their first.
Tech, that's their first time out of the half.
There's the chain. So the Bears out and chat. Montana Tech will chat about it as well. Let me get you updated on our scores here. Oregon beating Carroll 7-10. Southern Oregon is leading the College of Idaho 17-14. So could have a conference by the end of the day.
Absolutely, yep.
Is that any surprise to anyone? So Montana Tech calls their first time out. They have two remaining this football game. There's
side here. You got to that the Rockies going and get them offsides. Now they'll be at the line of scrimmage, and the play clock hasn't even started here yet. Defensively, you have to communicate that.
Second down and 7. Tech brings 5 up to the defensive front. Nathan Dick bounces it out on the edge. Dick tries to turn it upfield. He's cut down after a gain of 2.
Good
nice
play.
Job by Harmer to come up and make the stop.
I mean, Harmer's coming at full speed, and Dick, Dick's banged up here a little bit as he cut.
So
Harmer's coming at full speed, and Dick cut up against him, but he was able to rake his arm into Dick's legs and get him to the ground.
Coach Kyle Sampson and the trainer are the first two out there. The Rocky trainer's coming over. Nathan Dick hit the ground and was in pain. 1:57 left to play here in this football game. So a shot here for the Digs. Third down and 5. If they get the stop here on 3rd and 5, they'll get the football back with plenty of time. So both teams chatting it over here. Eastern and Carroll now tied up 17 apiece. So again, our other scores right now, Western is, it's a final. Western beat Northern 35-6. That one was in Haver. Southern is leading the College of Idaho 17-14, and Eastern and Carroll are knotted up 17 apiece. That one is in LeGrand.
Oh, wow.
So Eastern making a little bit of a push here. So the Nathan Dick still down. It looks like they're going to hoist him up with help. And remember, he got hurt late in the game against the College of Idaho, and it was an apparent foot injury of some kind. He was wearing a walking boot here, from what I was told, the bulk of the last 2 weeks.
He's walking off on his own, and since... So it was a,
it was a
timeout.
Timeout.
Timeout wasn't taken, so... No, they, so that's an injury timeout, right?
That is the case. Montana Tech still shows 2 timeouts. Injury timeout, so he has to go off for a play at least.
Or they could take get him back
there
on
go.
There if he feels like he can get back in the football game here. Yeah, this is it. This is it, Montana Tech. You have to stay onside, execute defensively. They probably won't put this in the backup quarterback's hands. They'll probably try and hand this off to Wilcox and see what he can do.
George Tribble. Tribble is your quarterback now for the Bears. 3rd down and 5. 1 back, trips receivers left. And the clock is running. The coaching staff yelling, why is the clock running? Coach Kyle Sampson caught it, was pointing at the clock. It started the run.
157, right? 157?
Yes, 157. Do you want to just go down there and tell them?
No, thanks.
All right. Third down at five. This thing's getting it's played out like the whole game has gone down. It's just incredibly interesting the way this game, and we've seen such swings, and nobody has just grabbed momentum and tried to ride it. The white hat and Coach Sampson talking about why the play clock was running. And the officials they're on the page of this must be a running clock due to the fact that they're discussing it still. I mean, if this was a case where they were in agreement, this would have been over seconds ago.
If this is a running clock, then if Montana Tech pleads their case and wants to get it back to 157, it may cost them a timeout then, correct?
Yep. So the official still points. Sampson is talking to him about it. Yeah, I mean, if they wouldn't be discussing it this long if they were in any kind of agreement. So the injury timeout must be that once the play is whistled, once the football is whistled live, basically.
You go back to live conditions.
You go back to live conditions.
Please put 157 back on the clock.
So they will put 157 on the clock. Let's see if they take a timeout away from Tech. They do not. Okay, so that was the case. It was not live. So 157 remaining. Third down and five. Tribble in for his first snap at quarterback today. He did play against the College of Idaho. He went 3 for 8 in that football game. Third down and five. Now the clock is running. Play clock at 15, so Tribble is going to let it roll down. Heads up play. The entire offensive line looked back at him, and Tribble pointed at the play clock going, "We have time." Play clock down to five. Tribble. Handoff, running. Tribble gets hit. Tribble leans forward. He'll get one and no more. Jake Orvis is there. Help with other guys as well. Tech will call a timeout. And the Digs will get the football back with 1:31 remaining in this game, trailing by 8.
You know, Montana Tech's got to be disciplined here. An offsides will give Rocky too much on that play, but he did get it within 5 yards of the first down marker, so there's a lot going on here. I always point that out because I kind of blew a game one time going offsides on punt return.
My goodness, this is crazy. Fourth down and five. Thanks, buddy. Montana Tech calls a timeout, so they'll huddle up here. Fourth and five. You'd have to assume we've seen both punt teams be very effective today, so you'd have to assume you're going to take this punt inside your 20, as really both special teams units have been really good.
I butchered Emery's name, and they have the phonetic breakdown of it on the back of the roster here. Okay. I should have looked.
Gotcha. So Emery Hurd, junior out of Chicago.
And Moyei. Well, I think I was pretty close on Moyei.
I think you were. So fourth and five. The punting unit is in. Montana Tech. Nobody in a three-point. Now we get one guy in a three-point. Otherwise, everybody upright. Remember, a running into the kicker threw this thing into a tailspin a little bit ago. The punt is away. End-over-end kick. Torgerson will field it at the 4. Torgerson cuts back here on the near side, switches hands. He's across the 15 to the 16. Montana Tech needs to go 84 yards for 8 points to put this thing to overtime. They need
doable.
The touchdown and the 2-point conversion.
It's doable. It starts with pass protection. You've got to get, you know, for the most part, unless you get a blitz and man coverage, this ball has to travel 10 yards past the line of scrimmage. You just have to know that any completion is beyond the mark for a first down, so you get that abbreviated stoppage of the clock and, you know, time for your offense to get to the line of scrimmage.
Jed Campbell, 18 to 34 for 194 yards through the air today. He has one back, one receiver left, 2 to the right. Montana Tech with one timeout remaining. Jed Campbell, three-man pressure coming. Campbell stands in the pocket, pump fake once. Campbell is going to run. He's across the 20, out to the 23, and if you're Rocky, you love that decision. The clock is going to run. They get 7 yards out of it, and Montana Tech looking to get up to the line of scrimmage quickly. We're down to 1:02 left to play. One back, tight end left, 3 receivers. Under a minute remaining in the football game. Jed Campbell takes one step, stands in the pocket. Now he's going to run again, and he'll be hauled down awkwardly after a gain of 1.
You're probably going to take a timeout here. You're almost forced to.
45 seconds remaining. Campbell gets up limping and holding his left leg a little bit. And Montana Tech does take their final timeout. So good coverage downfield, it looked like, by Rocky. has packed it up and ran here the last two. That'll bring up third down and two, but more importantly, they have a long way to go for points here with 43 seconds remaining and no timeouts left in this football game. Offense chatting it over here. Rocky leading 28-20. Frontier Conference action here on a Saturday. Western's game is done. Western beat Northern in Havre.
Boy, I don't hate a back screen here. You know, you got to think of plays that, you know, can pick up a couple yards, right? But have the potential to go for big if they're executed properly. So I think of a play like back counts in there helping on the pass coverage here in this series, and you get eager defensive front guys that want to get sacks, and you get careful secondary, so you get deep pass drops out of your linebacker set. I'd like to see him come back to this back screen and let Campbell let it develop a little bit.
Third and one, Blake Counts out of the backfield. Two receivers, right? Pressure from three, handoff to Counts. Counts straight ahead. He's out to the 35, 37-yard line. The stop until the chains are moved, and then it will start again. So the chains are in movement. Montana Tech is at the line of scrimmage. So they're ready to snap once that football goes down. And they will spike the football. So 37 seconds remaining here in this ball game. The chains are set. Montana Tech looking at second down and 10. The Digs now have run 69 offensive plays, 332 total yards. They've turned the ball over four times today.
They're getting a lot of quarters coverage. Boy, I'd like to see Montana Tech run a little post-wheel action with a pair of receivers out here and see if you can't get a safety to remain inside the hash mark.
Campbell out of the shotgun. One back, snap almost went by him. Campbell snags it, rifles it across the middle. Pass complete to Torgerson at the 50. That's going to move the chains again. A fresh set of downs here for Montana Tech. And again, once they move the chains and set them, Montana Tech will spike the football. 30 seconds remaining. So the Digs down by 8. Need the touchdown and a two-point conversion. They're looking at second and 10 at the 49-yard line.
Boy, a really nice catch. That wasn't an easy catch to make by Torgerson. Knew he was going to take a shot. Had to get across the first down markers. And Campbell stood in there, got the ball delivered. Torgerson made a tough catch in traffic and gave this offense a little more life.
Two receivers each way here for Jet Campbell. Campbell has passed for 207 yards here today. Rocky brings three up. Blitz is coming. They're bringing five. Campbell stands. Campbell going to run. He has a ton of running room. He's across the 40, 35, down near the 30, 25 and out of bounds at the 25, and he is limping as he goes to the sideline. So a big run for Campbell, a 26-yarder, as he's still limping, comes back onto the field of play.
Now you're in a legitimate shot to tie this game, a really legitimate shot. Any seam route, any corner route, of course, any post or any go is touchdown yardage. So you're gonna condense this Rocky defense. It's just adamant. Pass protection's everything here now. So the pressure's on that defensive or the offensive front and Counts in the backfield. But if you get to the second level, you've got a chance here.
Dropping back, four-man pressure. He's looking middle. That one's picked off at the four-yard line. Intercepted at the four-yard line. Jack Klein gets the pick, and Rocky is going to get the win.
He just threw that ball a little too far inside. You know, he needed to keep that up the hash mark, and Alexander had a chance.
The fifth turnover of the day for Montana Tech will result in a W for Rocky Mountain College. The Digs came in plus 5 on turnovers today, and they have 5 themselves here on the afternoon. So Klein gets the interception. Rocky will go to 2-1. Montana Tech will go to 2-1. And we could see a pretty good shakeup in the Frontier Conference here as this one continues. So Montana Tech threatened. And now the Rocky offense will come out and take victory formation as Tribble will go into the victory. Tribble take a knee, and that's going to do it. So Tribble will take a knee, and the Battling Bears will go to 2-1 in conference. Montana Tech will fall to 2-1 in conference play as the Battling Bears will take down the Digs here in the Mining City. Montana Tech swept the Battling Bears a year ago, and getting a big one here today.
Surprise, but the week I told them this is going to be a good football game. Rocky's a good football team. They got a tremendous leader at quarterback in Nathan Dick. Really led that squad today against a defense that's playing really good football and continues to play really good football at Montana Tech. And Rocky brought their game today defensively. They did enough on offense, but defensively they had a sound plan today and they executed it really well.
28-20 our final. Rocky over the Digs here with Montana Tech. We'll take a quick timeout. We'll come back. We'll wrap up your numbers and put this one in the books right after this. Hey, welcome back here once again to the campus of Montana Tech as the team's going through the handshake line here. The Battling Bears will get the win over Montana Tech. 28-20 is our final. And again, that is the 135th meeting. Rocky will get their 50th win over Montana Tech. The Digs with 85 wins, 50 losses, 3 ties to Rocky through the years. And Rocky getting a big win here today. Turnovers. I mean, it just boils down to that. Montana Tech with 5 turnovers. Rocky gets 3 touchdowns off of those 5. And you can just roll it up and put it away at that point.
Nobody likes to turn the ball over. But teams with electric, high-scoring, fast-paced, big chunk yardage offenses don't sweat them out near as much as in a game like this. It's a war of attrition. And, every snap matters. Every yard, two teams that are playing just smash mouth football all day long. It just it certainly cost Montana Tech. They'll learn a lot from this game. All their goals are still in front of them. They're going to be 2-1 with what sounds like a slew of teams in this conference, and just kind of move forward. They'll learn a lot from this game. They'll understand the importance of turning the ball over, and you got to credit Rocky. They came in with a good plan. I thought Montana Tech had a good plan as well. The game was everything I expected today. Fairly low scoring, and two teams really mixing it up. Hard-hitting football game. Had some penalties that kind of cost the respective teams here today, but turnovers certainly told the story.
28-20, our final. Number-wise, Montana Tech runs 74 offensive plays for 383 yards. They ended up with 24 first downs in this ball game. They ran the ball 37 times for 176 total yards. Campbell has 14 carries for 105 yards. He had a rushing touchdown as well. Counts at 15 carries for 85 on the ground. Let's talk about Campbell through the air. 19-37 throwing the football. He had 2 interceptions here today, threw 1 touchdown. Down, and he completed for 207 yards. So again, Campbell 19-37 for 207 and a score. Receiving wise, Hoffman 7 catches for 63. Alexander 3 for 59. Torgerson 6 catches for 54. Kennedy had 1 for 20. Counts 1 for 6. And Peterson 1 for 5 on the day. So again, the Digs 74 offensive plays, 383 yards. And again, 5 turnovers here on the day. 3 fumbles, 2 interceptions. On the other side for Rocky, they ran 70 offensive plays for 301 yards. Nathan Dick was 17-26 for 149 yards through the air. He threw 1 touchdown, and he was not their leading rusher. Wilcox had 20 carries for 81 yards on the day. Nathan Dick, 18 carries for 68. Receiving-wise, Henry, 4 catches for 43. Wilcox, 4 for 40. Simon had 4 for 37. Simons were all big catches, too. Yeah. Felt like third down, third, 7 and 8. Simon was the go-to man in those scenarios. McCrain had one catch for 14. Killian, Rooney, and Dwyer each had one catch as well. So Rocky runs 70 offensive plays for 301. Tech runs 74 offensive plays for 383. And Rocky goes to 2-1. Montana Tech falls to 2-1. Let's run you through the other scores here quickly. Fourth quarter, Carroll leading Eastern 20-17. In a lightning delay, Southern and the College of Idaho, Southern leading College of Idaho 17-14. That one in a lightning delay, and as we said, Western beat Northern 35-6, the final in that one.
All right.
There we go. So for Montana Tech, remember the Bulldogs of UM Western are next. That one will be in Dillon, and I certainly look forward to that, and we'll hopefully see you down there as well as Montana Tech at Western for what should be a great rivalry game and a game that, like every game in the Frontier Conference, is going to mean an awful lot as we get to it on Saturday.
Yeah, that's Western's going to be really eager to play this team. They're always up for this game. Coach Norris doesn't let them sleep too long. They're always ready for the next opponent. So, yeah, I look forward to another really hard-hitting, scrappy football game.
So, again, thanks for joining us here with Montana Tech as the Bears get the win 28-20 as we make our way through a Saturday. The Digs 2-1, Rocky 2-1, and that's the deal here from Bob Greenfield. For Ron Haskett, I'm Paul Panisco. Thanks for joining us on a Saturday. Until next time, take care.